Our agenda today is to take evidence from the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport in relation to the Financial Memorandum for the National Care Service Scotland Bill. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Donna Bell, Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development, and Fiona Bennett, Interim Deputy Director for the NHS Integration and Social Care Finance. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you for inviting me today to discuss spending on the National Care Service programme. Let me say to begin with that this government remains committed to delivering a national care service to improve the quality and consistency of community health and social care support across Scotland. Through our summer co-design activities, we've heard from hundreds of people with real experience of both accessing support and delivering it, and it's clearer than ever that the system needs to change if we are to deliver the services that people need. Having said that, we're in a different situation from when the National Care Service Bill was introduced in June 22. The timings for the bill have changed. We originally expected the bill to be completed by now. That has given us additional time to have deeper discussions with key partners and stakeholders, as well as advancing the co-design activities. But it's also obviously affected the profiling of expenditure, with development activities taking place over a longer time rather than moving on to implementation. We're also, of course, in different fiscal circumstances than we were in June 22. There's an increased pressure to find different ways of working to make the best use of public funds available. The NCS programme had a small number of consultancy projects during its initial stages to provide research and advice, but this has been significantly reduced in the current year, and we're focusing on providing the skills required through our own staff. In addition to the internal spend on developing National Care Service, this government is increasing spend on frontline social care. More than £1.7 billion has been provided for social care and integration in 23 and 24. And we are committed to increasing spend in social care by at least 25% by the end of this parliament, an increase of over £840 million. So far, spend has increased by £800 million since 21-22, so we are well ahead of this target. However, simply spending more will not deliver. The improvements that people are calling for in the quality of social care support and in giving people choice and control over the support that they receive. We need to change the system, and I believe the new approach that we are developing with greater national oversight and strengthened integration at the local level is what we need to achieve that. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that opening statement, which was very helpful. I mean, I think it's interesting to see where we are compared to less than a year ago, and I think it's now broadly accepted that the financial memorandum that was brought before us was simply not up to the job, and I think it's good that the Scottish Government has had a complete rethink on that. I mean, obviously, what's important for us in terms of financial memorandum is that we are able to scrutinise it effectively. On the 9th of May, you said that it's your intention to give us 4 weeks in order to scrutinise that. Is that still the government's position before the stage one debate?
Yes, it is.
Okay, well, thank you. I think that's very important to get that clarification on the record. I mean, one of the things I think that's of concern to myself, and I'm sure other members will raise it, is that the costs that we have been provided with, looking, for example, at the costs in 22-23 and the current year, don't really tell as much other than kind of top line, and I think it would be useful to try and dig down into that. So I'm going to do a wee bit of digging, and I'm sure colleagues will do even more as the meeting progresses. So I'm just wondering if you can explain to us, I mean, you talked in your opening statement there about the need to look again at profiling of expenditure, but if we look at 21-22, we see in the annex the actual costs after revision, which are obviously the most important, that staff was £1.387 million was spent. The following year, that increased quite dramatically to £9.8 million, and one would anticipate that because obviously a lot more work is being done to kind of flesh out the kind of legislation. But in the current financial year, in the first quarter, it seems to me, That seems to have fallen back quite significantly to £923,000, which is perhaps only about a third of what the quarterly spend had been in the previous financial year. So I'm just wondering if you can explain to us why there's been such a dramatic change in those figures.
So I think much of the staff costs attributed to the programme are around training and travel, and there will have been more training at the start of this transition compared to as we progress through it. I don't know, Fiona, if you want to give a little bit more detail on what that is. There will probably also be something on outturn and reconciliation.
Yeah, there are various reasons, and again, we're happy to give a fuller breakdown in writing afterwards. Part of it is also the reduced use of contractors. So wherever possible, we've brought in permanent staff within the core team as civil servants, which have less cost than external contractors in terms of filling specific roles. So we've been really keen to upskill permanent staff, which will also have an impact in cost. But again, we're happy to provide any more detail in terms of the breakdown of those staff costs between specific teams.
Yeah, yes, I know consultancy figures are about £246,000 less than anticipated, but it seems an awful lot of money to be training people on a bill which we don't actually know how it's going to look at this point. I mean, one of the things that's made clear in terms of the papers that we've received is that a lot of the co-design work is still taking place and will continue to take place. So I'm just wondering what this staff training was on.
Co-design.
Yeah, so
co-design is a new method of developing legislation. It's not, we have used it before in the Scottish Parliament and in Scottish Government, but some of the training costs will have been on co-design methods to ensure that people were aware how to engage with lived experience and how to make sure that lived experience made its way to the heart of the legislation. I'll ask Donna to give you a little bit more detail.
Yeah, so in addition to the support for the co-design process, the National Care Service programme is quite a big and complex programme. So we've also ensured that staff have a good understanding of programme management, a good understanding of scheduling. There has been financial management training and various other aspects. I think one other thing to add on the costs for period one is that there have been some adjustments made to that. So in terms of what is included in the programme and what is not. So once we have that breakdown that we'll very happily provide, we can give you any understanding of changes to what has been included in the programme and what hasn't. So, and I suppose I'm sure Ms Todd would be happy to expand on this. It is quite difficult to differentiate between the work that's going on to improve social care and integration right now, what the improvements are needed to create the right conditions for the National Care Service, and what is specifically attributed to the National Care Service programme, because obviously that is all very, very, very connected. So there has been some adjustment to what is included in the programme costs and what isn't.
Okay, you'll understand that that makes scrutiny quite difficult. I mean, one of the points that came out of the letter on 9th of May was, Minister, when you said it is not possible to separate costs relating to the provisions of the bill and those which result from the wider NCS programme. And that does make it very difficult to assess where public money is being spent effectively. I'm just wondering if you can give us a wee bit more information on that. One of the reasons the financial memorandum caused such alarm to the committee was because we weren't really getting these breakdowns, and because of obviously the size and scale of the monies involved.
So with the exception of a very small dedicated bill management team, the majority of officials working on the National Care Service are involved in teams which combine policy development, co-design and implementation across a range of areas. And these activities will inform the development of the bill, but also the more detailed development of the National Care Service, which will be set out in secondary legislation, guidance and practice in many areas that also feed into improvements of the current service. And you'll have heard me say many times, we don't need to wait for the National Care Service Bill. We don't need to wait for primary legislation. We can make improvements in this area now, and we are seeking those those areas which we can improve without legislation on a regular basis. So officials continue to review priorities in line with the current fiscal position at all times to focus on improving services for people who access social care support. I'm more than happy to furnish you with as much detail as we possibly can. I want you to be able to scrutinise this bill. We're not trying to hide anything from you. We are keen to use your scrutiny to improve what we do.
Okay, I mean, in terms of that, I'm going to go into the figures a minute or two before I let colleagues in. But just one of the things that's been said is that an initial consensus proposed between the Scottish Government and COSLA on behalf of local government has been formed in a partnership approach that will provide for shared legal accountability. This will improve the experience of people accessing services by introducing a new structure of national oversight to drive consistency of outcomes while maximising the benefits of a reformed local service delivery. And you go on to talk about the formation of a national board to provide national oversight and governance of social work, social care, support and community wealth. So I'm just wondering if you can let us know just how that's going to actually work and when that body is likely to be up and running, so to speak.
So the final details are still being decided, but we have made this agreement between the national, between ourselves, Scottish Government, COSLA, and the National Health Service, that there will be shared accountability. I would envisage a board with other people on it as well, including, for example, lived experience. I would expect staff side to be represented on that board. I would expect the National Social Work Agency to be on that board. And that board will oversee and scrutinise the National Care Service as it's delivered. Importantly, I would expect to build it with some teeth so that if there is service delivery failure, action can occur. Action can be taken in order to ensure that service delivery is successful. So we haven't quite finalised negotiations on that National Care Board, but I think that's an absolutely crucial part of the oversight. I find it frustrating at the moment that I am regularly held to account for the national, for the delivery of social care across the country, and of course I have no legal responsibility for it. It sits entirely with local government, and I have no powers to change what goes on. So this aligns with Derek Feely's vision as per the independent review of adult social care, and it also aligns with what the country told us in our consultation, which is that they want national government to have some say and oversight of social care.
Now, one of the areas and the figures which obviously draw the eye is the expenditure on engagement. So, for example, it was envisaged that in the last financial year that would be £475,000, but it turned out to be £1,026,000. And it's declining to a very small £7,000 in the most recent quarter of the current financial year. So I'm just wondering why the Scottish Government got those figures sort of out of kilter with regard to engagement. Why there's been such a decline? Does that mean that, I mean, with co-design, I would have thought there had been more engagement rather than less. So I'm just wondering what the kind of thinking of the Scottish Government is with regard to that.
Again, I'll ask either, I'm not sure who's most appropriate, Fiona, perhaps, to give you a bit more detail, but I think that's about the reprofiling of the spend. So when we introduced the bill last year, we expected the bill to have completed its passage through Parliament by now. We expected to have a bill and to be in the implementation phase, and that is not what's occurred. So that's why the predictions of what the spend at each stage were have not turned out to be the case, because we've done things at a very different pace, and we've taken the opportunity to develop expertise within government to ensure that we have the best value for money as we go. But I don't know, Fiona, if you want to say more about that.
Yeah, another factor in it is the timing of grant funding. So part of that engagement line includes grant funding for some disabled people's organisations to support engagement, for example, the people-led policy panel. So part of that is the timing of when the grant expenditure is recognised as that process is worked through and paid out to the people receiving it. So as the year goes on, again, we can update that spend each month as we have that, but that is part of the reason for the change in profile because of the grant expenditure.
Yeah, it'd be useful to have more detail on this. I'm going to let colleagues in just in a second, but just would Minister, would you agree that the bill now seems to be more one of evolution than revolution? The kind of big bang that we saw last year, in which kind of hit the rocks of a financial memorandum that simply didn't add up, has now been transformed, and the government is actually looking at something which is radically different from what it was a year ago.
So I would agree that it's less of a big bang, but I would say it's still pretty bold and transformational. People have been very clear, particularly over the course of the summer when we've engaged with people with lived experience, people who access social care and people who work in social care. They want change. They want the system to change. The status quo is not good enough. So I still think that what we will deliver will be bold and transformative, but it'll be a more phased approach. We are very keen to take people with us on that journey of transition. Certainly when I became minister, just 6 months or so ago, we were in a very different place. And it wasn't just the financial memorandum that was causing people concern. There was lots of opposition to the bill. We've worked really hard to work with our partners over the course of the summer to ensure that we are all agreed in the direction that we are pulling in. And we are now all very focused on delivering that transformative change that the people of Scotland are telling us they very clearly want.
Okay, so the objective remains the same, it's just the path to it that has changed.
And the pace.
Indeed. Okay, Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Good morning, panel. Thank you for attending. Before I ask my main couple of questions, I just wanted to pick up on a question earlier about training. I think it was yourself, Donna, who said that it involved programme management training, particularly around FM and scheduling. But from my experience of many years ago being a programme manager, those fundamentals in delivery are, you know, you can't deliver anything without a basic knowledge of scheduling, financial matters altogether. I suppose that kind of worried me a wee bit. What on earth made you think you could deliver before without having those basic, that basic skill set in place in the first place?
Yeah, so I completely understand. I would be worried if that were the case. So we have some very experienced people who have many years of experience in the programme management world. I think what is really important is that everybody is approaching the programme in the same way, and we all have a common understanding of what's required. So we do have new people who are involved in policy development. We do have people whose background is policy development. So this was about upskilling everyone rather than a kind of greenfield site, if you like. So, you know, we do have significant experience, certainly within the cohort of people who are working on the programme.
And again, I obviously am pleased to hear that, but it does make me think what on earth was happening before the scale of this, that not being in place. These are fundamental skills, and I've often seen issues where the focus has been on policy, but without the associated rigour on delivery. So I suppose the question for me before I move on to the main areas are, you now confident, and I'll ask you yourself, Minister, are you now confident that across the board that skill set is in place because it is so fundamental to delivery?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. And one of the concerns around the last financial memorandum was the ability to scrutinise it detail because it's a framework bill. So therefore, my question is, how will the new approach set out by the convener of evolution rather than revolution alleviate risks and mitigate them? and what new risks will it introduce?
Gosh. So I think we will be more able to update everyone as we go along. So I think there will be better communication and information flow. So as well as us receiving information and taking on board lived experience and developing the bill in response to that, there will be more time to ensure that we inform those who need to know of what changes and evolution is occurring. There are always risks with a bill of this complexity, and I think there remains risk. I am absolutely confident, though, that we're going to deliver. I'm absolutely confident that we have the right people, the right skill set, and we are now motoring together to deliver something absolutely transformative for the people of Scotland, and it's I would have to say it's really exciting to be involved.
I suppose a follow-on question from that is that in terms of one of our concerns before was around secondary legislation, that it therefore lacks scrutiny over what could be significant spend over a long term. So will the new approach in terms of evolution run revolution result in more secondary legislation that potentially means, from our perspective as a finance committee, less oversight on the spend on an ongoing basis? Is that not a logical extension of that approach?
So we've talked a little bit about the oversight of secondary legislation, and I guess there's set out in the rules of the Parliament and the normal procedure a sort of minimum level of scrutiny for secondary legislation. I'd be very comfortable with enhancing that level of scrutiny in order that the Parliament is comfortable with what we are doing. So we welcome your scrutiny. We want to work with you to make this the best bill we possibly can, because we want to deliver improvement for the people of Scotland. So I think that we can definitely ensure that there is a level of scrutiny across the board of all the legislation that you are comfortable with. I think one of the key pieces of work that this committee will be interested in is the business case, and we regularly, that's a dynamic document, as you would expect, we regularly update it, and we'll make sure that we keep you appraised of how the business case is looking going forward as well.
And I would just put on the record, I very much welcome any further opportunities for us to capture baseline costs as near upfront as possible, rather than them slipping into secondary legislation. So feel free to write to the committee after this with any additional ideas, because I suspect it's probably a concern for all. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. List to be followed by John.
Thank you. Minister, you've spoken about co-design, and that was something that your predecessor was very keen on as well when he attended the committee on the 8th of November last year. Can I just ask about this co-design, for which I think the principles sound sensible? The trouble is that co-design is obviously ongoing, which you've reiterated again this morning. If it's ongoing, surely that means that it is very difficult indeed to forecast in detail what the costs are going to be at the end of the process.
So I guess what I'm trying to describe here is a dynamic process of us taking on board the co-design and then coming back to you with more information. The business case is an iterative business case, so I think we'll have lots of opportunities for you to scrutinise and examine what's going on. I think the co-design, I mean, the idea that we use co-design to develop the legislation, I think, is really absolutely fundamental to the type of change that we deliver. So I say very regularly to people, if we have lived experience at the heart of our policy and legislation, we are much more likely to get it right. What we also do, though, is, and the challenge is always in implementation, what we also do is have a built-in mechanism to hold our feet to the fire on implementation, to make sure that not only do we deliver an ambitious policy, not only do we deliver ambitious legislation, but that we actually implement it appropriately on the ground. And I guess what I'm trying to say here is that for me, co-design is a co-part of the National Care Service. So I would expect, much like the NHS, that once we have delivered a national care service, it will continue to evolve. It won't be fixed in stone, just as the NHS is not fixed in stone in the way that it was introduced in 1948. But having co-design at the heart of the development, having co-design at the heart of the National Care Service, means that the voice of lived experience will continue to be involved in its evolution even after we deliver the legislation. I agree it does make it more difficult for you to scrutinise costs.
Yeah, and that's the point for this committee. I mean, I absolutely understand why co-design could be beneficial, particularly for the input of many people who feel that the existing system is not satisfactory. I absolutely understand that, and I understood it at the time when Kevin Stewart spoke to us. Where I am concerned is that the process of the engagement is still ongoing, and we know from the last time that whilst many people who are on the front line of the service were concerned about making a change, there were lots of other people who were in the delivery of the service who were quite critical, in fact very critical in a few cases, of what the Scottish Government was saying and proposing. My point is that I think it's a bit of the cart before the horse, that if the co-design is ongoing for very good reasons, is it not the case that we should finish that process before we come back with what the actual detail of the bill will be, and therefore the forecast of the cost? Would that not be an easier way of doing this?
That might be an easier way of doing it, but I think that we can deliver both. So I think we can have co-design absolutely at the heart of our development of legislation, and we can ensure that this committee and others are comfortable with the financial scrutiny.
Can I just go back on that? How do you propose to put in front of this committee what the true costs will be? I mean, any financial memorandum can't be absolutely 100% accurate. We all accept that. But it has to be much more accurate than the one that we were presented with before. What my point is, I don't see how we're going to be able to get to that situation, given that there is this ongoing engagement from which there may become many more suggestions about how the bill might improve. So it's very difficult to get to the cost structures that this committee needs to scrutinise. Do you accept that?
So I'm confident that we will be able to provide you with an updated financial memorandum that will give you sufficient comfort 4 weeks before the bill. I'll ask Fiona to give you a little bit more information about what we're doing and how we're going to do that to reassure you today.
Yeah, thank you. And as noted, I mean, it will contain a range of assumptions and a range of cost estimates that would be expected at this stage while that co-design work continues. We've mentioned the business case process, which again, I think is very important. When we're at the programme business case stage and strategic outline business case stage, we would expect there to be, for example, optimism bias built into that in line with Green Book guidance that is compliant with how we should do things. As we move into the outline business case and full business case, those costs, as expected, would narrow to be much more specific and much more detailed. So we'll follow that business case process through. But absolutely, at the start, while we have uncertainties, while we're working through that co-design process, the agreement with COSLA, there will be a range in there, there will be assumptions, and there will still be risks while that cost profile narrows through the business case process.
So, Minister, can I ask, how long do you envisage the co-design process taking? How many more months are we going to be doing that?
So is it... Co-design is a core part of the development of the National Core Service. I don't expect it to finish by Christmas. I expect it to continue throughout the development of the bill and to be a fundamental part of the National Care Service going forward. I'll ask Donna to give you a little bit more information.
Yeah, so as you would expect, given the content of the bill, we have prioritised the areas that are key to the development of the legislation and to providing information to Parliament and to others. And also the things that are most important to people over the summer. So there were five co-design themes that are very specific to the development of the legislation. That, coupled with the engagement with local government, trade unions, the NHS, means that we will have a better understanding of what people want from this and also what partners want to contribute to the legislation. So while the co-design process will be long-term and enduring and will be a key part of the National Care Service. We are prioritising the areas that have the most impact on the bill, which will enable us to provide you with the assurance that you need.
Just tell us what these are.
So the five co-design themes are keeping care local, information sharing, models of care, and I've had a mental block there. Fiona, do you happen to have them in front of you? Sorry, I should know these. I have been at multiple co-design events. I'll find them. So those are the particularly issues around the keeping care local, information sharing, which has been the most popular theme, interestingly, and the reports are due to be published on all of those, so the committee will be able to review them themselves. So I think that prioritisation and doing this on an iterative basis is actually quite a helpful thing to do, so that the bill is suitably framed, and then as we get into more detail from the perspective of the framework and secondary legislation, it allows us to engage very proactively in the co-design process on additional detail. I think one thing that's really important is that this is not service delivery design. So we're not setting out at this point how specific services will operate at a local level. That will very much be for the local partnership arrangements in the future. So this is about getting that broad frame right and making sure that we have the information and the input from people that's required.
Okay, thank you. My last point relates to one of the difficulties that we had last year at this time, namely that there was very strong criticism of the Scottish Government's proposals from people who would be on the front line of delivery. And that included some in council authorities, that included some in care services, and that was obviously in a bit of a contrast to those who felt that the actual care side, those who experienced the care. So there was a bit of a contrast between the views. Have you consulted in great depth those who were critical because they felt that the costs had not been fully set out? Those who were telling you that the bill for the whole thing was going to be much more than perhaps you had predicted. Do we actually have some statistics for the figures that people in COSLA, local government, said were a bit of a concern last time? Has that arithmetic taken place?
So the focus of the discussion with COSLA hasn't actually been around the cost. It has been more around they were very concerned about the transfer of staff, and they wanted to maintain statutory responsibilities for commissioning and procurement. So the focus was less about financial costs and more about power and assets. And I think we've worked really closely with our local authority partners. I think the Verity House agreement has helped us in that. We've also worked very closely with unions who have been critical of the approach that we took. And as I say, I feel that we are in a much healthier place where we are working closely together. We don't always agree, I'll be honest, but we're working very closely together with our eyes firmly on the goal of delivering an improved service that works for the people who access care and for the people who are working in care as well.
I think that's very important. I would just say that I think what's even more important is that the costs that go along with these changes have to bring confidence that the bill will be deliverable. That's the area that concerns this committee. And I would suggest, Minister, I think there's still an awful lot of work to be done before the next financial memorandum comes back to this committee, that we get a much better idea of these costs, given that there is such a widespread divergence of opinion about it. Thank you.
Before I let John in, Michelle's keen to come in with a supplementary. Michelle.
Yeah, I suppose it's just picking up on that point that Liz made. As well as finance here, we've also got public administration. And obviously we all know that the public purse is just under the most difficult cosh at the moment. So arguably every penny is a prisoner, to use the terminology. That suggests to me that the relentless focus on the cost and value must be accentuated. But to be honest, I'm not necessarily sure I'm yet getting that confidence. For example, the Verity House Agreement, we all agree, is a positive, but we don't yet, and that's just been the process, we don't yet understand how that fiscal framework will work. That work's not been done. So I suppose, again, it's a question that, as well as a top-down policy-driven and thematic approach you've outlined, you're also absolutely doing the work to make sure every single funding line is really managed very tightly, because I think that underpinning is what will give us confidence, not just in the finances, but in terms of our responsibility as a public administration part of our committee remit.
Yes, certainly. And certainly when we come back to you, the financial memorandum, I would expect you to be able to have absolute confidence in what we produce.
And just a wee thing off the back of that, we haven't gone on to it today, and we may well at some point in the future, but in terms of the National Care Service Board and the governance therein, I would also, and I suppose it's a flags up, expect to see the same rigour around how the financial governance will operate in the light of current times as the policy element of it and the standard governance things. So again, can I ask that you give that just as much attention, in other words, a bottom-up as well as a top-down approach?
Absolutely, and I'm confident that we can improve the local scrutiny of spend. You know, there are times at the moment where it is hard to follow the money, and that is sometimes the explanation for challenging situations on the ground. I think if we empower our local structures and provide them with adequate data and ability to scrutinise where money is going within the system, I think we'll have a system that operates much more efficiently, but also much more effectively delivers for people.
Being able to follow the money is something that will work for us, I sense, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks so much, convener. One of the quotes that the convener used earlier on was from your letter from July, and it talked about consistency of outcomes, so presumably that's one of the main aims. And sometimes there is a bit of a tension, I think, between consistency of outcomes nationally and doing things locally, which we've just had referred to us as well. And I just wonder how then that will impact on costs, because, for example, in the Highlands, distances are greater, so if somebody's coming to visit somebody at home, that takes them longer, further to hospital, so that's a different issue. Similarly, but by contrast, in Glasgow, I think sometimes the feeling is you have to be in greater need in Glasgow to get an intervention than you do in some other authorities, just because the need is so huge. So that then leads me to think, well, at the moment, COSLA and the different councils get their funding through a formula. Is the National Care Service going to kind of override that formula, or will finances be targeted at areas of greater need, or how will that work?
So I think you're absolutely right. You've picked out one of the real tensions in the bill and within the idea of national oversight of the social care system. And you're preaching to the converted. I come from the rural West Highlands. I represent the northernmost and biggest mainland constituency in Scotland, and I absolutely recognise that care cannot be delivered in exactly the same way in exactly the same part of Scotland, in every part of Scotland. I think even within NHS Highland, the health board area that I live in, and you know, NHS Highland has its own model of integration. We've got the lead agency model, the rest of the country has a different model of integration. In Ullapo, where I live, the accessing care is a very different experience to accessing care in Inverness, which is a city much more like Edinburgh. So there are really fundamental differences throughout the country. What we are focused on is the unnecessary variation. So there should be a certain, you know, those thresholds of need shouldn't vary quite so much throughout the country. There shouldn't be a variation in quality throughout the country. That's not acceptable, that people in one part of the country have to accept a lower quality of care. We want the standards to be high everywhere. There are variations in pain conditions which are really challenging and threaten service delivery in parts of the country. So if you look at the social work profession, for example, unlike for nursing colleagues or teaching colleagues, there isn't a standardised approach to their pay and conditions. And I think that working through the National Social Work Agency, we will be able to improve that. And I think even in our engagements all over the country, there is a, I mean, I'll use Shetland as an example. It was my, I really enjoyed visiting Shetland. I hadn't been back for a number of years since pre-pandemic, and it was a real pleasure to go back to an area that I used to represent who have integrated health and social care very well. Now, they were, I would have to say, fairly healthily sceptical that the National Care Service would offer them anything, because they are doing things pretty well as things stand. But we were very quickly able to identify certain areas where a national approach could support that local delivery. So things like support around social work training, things like information sharing, which requires legislative change in order for them to be able to do it, and will vastly improve the experience for people on the ground. So I agree there's a tension. I agree it needs to be done very, very carefully. But I think it's possible to raise standards generally and to reduce unnecessary variation without impacting too much on the way that people do things locally. One of the other really important things, I mean, I often think, and it may again be down to the part of the country that I represent, I often think about young people with disabilities who access care packages, who then find it impossible to move freely around the country because those care packages don't follow them. We need to improve that system and make it more straightforward for them. I want young people in the Highlands to be able to go to university, and that almost inevitably means going away. I want them to be able to access education. I want them to be able to choose employment that suits them. And they need to be able to move around. And that's something that this National Care Service can do. It can definitely improve that transition across boundaries that we currently have that's so impossible for them to navigate.
Well, that's a very full answer, and I appreciate that. I'm largely in agreement with that. So have we got to the detail yet as to how the finances would work? So say a young person has a care package in Shetland, then goes to a university in Aberdeen. Would the money move with them? Would that be up to the individual council, or would it be so nationalised that it would all come out of a national pot?
Do you want to?
Yeah, I can come in on some of that. So to your point kind of around the funding formula as well, you know, as you've outlined, we currently have NHS boards funded through NRAC, we have local government funded through GEE. One of the questions that we're working through with COSLA ahead of the bill at the moment is around, will the IGBs or reformed IGBs receive direct allocations? If so, what funding formula will that be on? I think we're all in agreement that would need to take cognizance of rurality, of demographics and local areas. In terms of the specifics of the funding following the individual, absolutely, we would need to work through a mechanism to allow that transparency to follow the money and allow those barriers to be broken down the Minister spoke of. So the detail, yes, has to be worked through, but our fundamental point is increasing the transparency through the funding formula to make it clear what services are being funded from which route, so as we can then follow that.
Okay, so we'll learn more about that in due course. That's great. I mean, the other point I had in your, during my temporary spell as convener of the committee, you wrote to me on the 16th of June, and one of the lines there said about supporting improvement in the delivery of social care support that are not reliant on the NCS legislation. So that kind of split between what we can do just now and what we what we need the legislation to do. Has that changed then, or is it in the process of changing so that we're less reliant on the bill and we could do more without the bill?
I mean, I think we're always looking for opportunities to improve the system now. And one of the things I would point to is that increase of wages to £12 an hour, that minimum funding. So that doesn't require us to wait for legislation. That's a decision of the Scottish Government to deliver that from next financial year. And I think that's something that's really, you know, I am so delighted that we're able to deliver that and we don't need to wait for primary legislation for that. I think there will be other areas that we can improve on, but some will require primary legislation. But, you know, we are always looking for opportunities to improve. I think just this week, isn't it? Is it perhaps? I think it's tomorrow we're getting a review of scrutiny and inspection. We'll be looking very keenly at that publication and seeing what we can do and how we can take on board the recommendations that come with that. I think the regime of scrutiny and inspection is one of the tools that we can use to improve quality and improve consistency. So to think of the outcomes that we're aiming for from this bill, I think that's a crucial piece of work. But not every recommendation, and I don't know, I can't preempt it, it's published tomorrow, I think, not every recommendation, I would imagine, will require primary legislation to make the change. And we'll be looking for changes that can occur without the legislation, because we're very keen to set ourselves on a trajectory of improvement in terms of delivery from day one, from now. Yeah.
Thank you. And just one minor point for clarity. Is that annex that you gave us, that was the letter of 16th June, and the figures were being quoted. So there's 21, 22, there's 22, 23, and then 23, 24, it says period one. Can I just check, is that the first month or is that the first quarter?
The first month.
So we
now have periods one to four. So again, we can give an update on this.
Right.
Figures.
So if I was wanting to find the annual figures, I could multiply these by 12 or roughly.
Roughly, perhaps. Yes.
Okay.
Apologies, when I was asking questions earlier on, I assumed it was a quarter. I didn't realise it was on a monthly basis. OK, thank you. Michael?
Thanks, Convener. Minister, you'll be aware the medium-term financial strategy of the government's projecting a £1 billion shortfall in 24-25, £1.9 billion in 27-28. What has the Finance Secretary told you that we, as a country, can afford to spend on the National Care Service?
So we are working very closely together on what the needs are of the country and what we can deliver. I would be candid, she hasn't set a ceiling. So we are looking to deliver a social care system that meets the needs of the population.
So she's not given any indication of what the envelope of spending that might be available within that would be?
So we have you'll know, we set out a financial memorandum this time last year. That was the envelope that was put forward with the original legislation. That is changing as we develop the legislation. But we are determined that this, to develop a system that meets the needs of the population. And you will be aware that there is a commitment at government level to do that. So I will continue to work closely with the Deputy First Minister to ensure that we are able to afford and deliver a national care service that works.
So Spice, Fraser of Allender, the Institute for Fiscal Studies all commented at the time of the medium-term financial strategy, pointed out the missing figures for this policy wasn't included in any of those projections. So whatever you're being given to spend in this area for making that happen isn't included in those figures. I mean, I suppose it comes to that kind of question in terms of what comes first in this question. You're talking a lot about co-design and putting in place the right system, but I'm not getting a sense of real confidence that we're working in a financially prudent way to think about actually what the limitations. So how much are those financial limitations informing the co-design process?
So I think we can, I mean, I don't know, Fiona, if you want to come in on this. I think we can reassure you when we bring forward the financial memorandum. I mean, I suppose what you're missing in your question is the value of social care. In some ways, you're looking entirely at the acquisition cost. If we get social care right, what it delivers is of huge value to the nation. I would expect that it makes a difference not just to the individual who accesses care, it makes a difference to their family, it makes a difference to their community. And there are some gains from spending more, so I would expect to see increase in productivity. All those people who tell me that they cannot work because of their caring duties, I would expect to be supported into employment. I think the, you know, increasing the wages of the lowest paid people in our country will bring an economic benefit. So you're only looking at the moment at one side of the balance sheet. I would expect there to be another side of the balance sheet. And of course, as well as looking at the current, so there's the current ways of raising money. There may well be different ways of raising money in the future. And of course, that's well outside my portfolio. Fiona?
Yeah, you've covered it really, Minister, but yeah, it was just to draw, you know, the £4 billion that we already spend on social care, as much if not more focus has to be on making sure we are getting value out of that large amount of expenditure that is in the system. Yes, absolutely, within the current fiscal framework, we have to look at minimising additionality of spend to create the National Care Service. We have to drive the value through the expenditure that's in the system, and indeed looking at the balance across health and care, so thinking about how we can invest in prevention, which longer term will better meet the demographic needs and be a more financially sustainable system.
And my assumption would be that that's what we would see in the business case, in part, in terms of the policy evaluation, that you would see the great social benefit, the preventative money, where we would save money. So I'm in full agreement, Minister, in terms of those huge benefits in a wide variety of ways, but we have to be able to pay for it. Yeah. Is the reality.
I suppose one simple example is if we can catch people, if we can shift the spend to more preventative, which is partly our intention. You know, we're absolutely determined. Christie over 10 years ago told us to spend money early rather than pulling people out of the water. So we want to spend money in a preventative fashion. If we can spend money preventatively, an elderly person who is admitted to hospital and gets a care package, that care package would cost on exit from hospital twice as much as it would have cost if we'd managed to catch them before they went in. So we can. There are efficiencies if we do this well. And I need to just provide you with assurance.
Yeah, I think so. We all know the huge costs of the failure to eliminate delayed discharge.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So
can I ask, have you taken a decision on the inclusion of children's services?
No.
No. So do we have any indication of the costs associated with that? I mean, that's thousands of staff, isn't it?
So there'll be a decision on that towards the end of the year.
Towards the end of the year.
One, and then the cost impacts will be included in the financial memorandum.
Yeah.
So on that, then, the time frame, you're committed in the letter to us to completing stage one by the 31st of January. So working back, the convener has got on the record 4 weeks prior to that. So we're looking at you, I think, by my reckoning, having to provide us with the financial memorandum in about the 11th of December. Mm-hmm. Is that... have you got a date in your diaries when you'll be sending the financial memorandum to the committee?
No. So when the stage one happens is not entirely within my control. You'd appreciate that's more in Parliament's control. But we'll certainly furnish you with a financial memorandum 4 weeks before, as promised.
I suppose what I'm kind of working towards here is that it's not very long.
No.
So, and it feels to me that there's an awful lot of moving parts. Questions from colleagues about, you know, we're still in the depths of co-design. We haven't taken a decision on the inclusion of key critical areas like children's services. There's huge financial issues around that. Taken into account recess, we're looking at roughly, by my reckoning, 11th of December that we would have to receive this. It's just weeks away, really. I mean, do we have a draft of the financial memorandum?
Can I maybe come in? So, and I suppose part of the spend that you see on staff that's included within the figures that you have is about all the groundwork to support the decision-making. So the as Ms Todd's already said, the business case continues to iterate, the financial memorandum continues to iterate. So, yes, we do have a draft, but it may not be the final form at this point. There's been a significant amount of work done on the research on children's services and on justice services, some of which has already been published, more of which will be published towards the end of October, beginning of November. So that will allow ministers and cabinet to reach informed conclusions. The groundwork is really, really important to make sure that those decisions are informed and are made with the best information possible.
Okay. My last question can be just relating to that specific issue. I mean, one of the issues relating to the inclusion of children's services was that most social work practitioners across Scotland had no idea that this is being proposed and that they might be transferred out of their current employers into some form of different employment, as yet to be decided. Has any proper engagement happened with the profession?
So there's a lot of engagement with the profession, but there isn't a proposal to transfer employment. I think the agreement between ourselves and COSLA means that that's no longer necessary for any staff.
That's good to hear. Thank you.
Thank you. Jamie?
Convener, good morning to the Minister and colleagues. I'm fairly new to this committee, so I'm not seeing this for the first time, but certainly some of the depth and detail, and I wasn't here during the discussions. Just following on from Michael Mara's points, you, and as he rightly said, for all the value, it's all got to be paid for this. I think, Minister, you hinted or suggested, and I'm not sure of the exact wording, but other ways of revenue being generated. Are we talking about tax, new taxes, increasing taxes, new fees to pay for this going forward if those costs are higher than expected?
So I'll be working very closely with the Deputy First Minister to make sure that we design a social care service that works for the people of Scotland. And the Deputy First Minister, as she does in every area of spend, will be making sure that we have sufficient funding to put behind that. That is definitely outside my remit.
So have there been discussions about the need for perhaps new revenue, ways of generating revenue for this scheme going forward?
So there are always discussions in government about how to generate revenue for public spend, and particularly in a time of constraint such as the moment, I would expect there to be ongoing discussion around that. You'll be aware of public statements around care and balance needing to be struck, but that's absolutely outside of my portfolio.
As Michael Mara rightly pointed out, there are a number of areas here that haven't been fully considered in terms of the bill going forward. The original financial memorandum suggested or estimated the cost of the bill over a five-year period, 2022 to 23 to 2026-27, to between 644 and 1,261 million. Do you consider that still to be the estimates or considerably higher?
Well, as I said, we're going to bring forward a revised financial memorandum.
Being looked at the moment, I mean...
Yeah, and considerably lower because of the rephasing of the introduction, particularly of the local structures. So it will be considerably lower over the time period quoted there.
Okay, and so, but that may, it'll be lower over that period perhaps, but you would expect it to be higher going forward or just...
Depending on the decisions taken, okay. Particularly in the first financial memorandum in Table 8, there was significant costs included about the potential transfer of staff. Because that has now been off the table, you would expect that to therefore... disappear, so we would expect it to be lower overall.
And I think as well, the rephasing means that the probably there'll be less spend because there's less need for external consultancy.
I mean, that maybe answers my another question which I was going to ask, which was regards to the cost that you've given here for the 2023-24 period one at 971,000 for just 1 month. The I think it was the Deputy First Minister said in February that the figure for 2023-24 is likely to be a figure no higher than 50 million. So you would expect that to be considerably less than that?
Yes. So that figure was reasonably close to the lower end of the range given in the financial memorandum, and at that stage we were still expecting the bill to go forward and be completed by the end of by summer, actually, which would have meant that the work would have ramped up and been phased completely differently, so that there would have been a lot of work going on in that financial year, which hasn't been needed with the extension of the bill timetable. It's spread over a much longer time, and that's the process of expenditure still being worked through.
So that's to the evolution rather than devolution, yep, rather than anything else. Okay. Just the last kind of question I had on this really was around the VAT liability. Obviously, there were concerns raised about the potential VAT liability, what that might be. Can you give us an update on where that is at the moment?
Yeah, happy to do so. So we updated last time that there are, what we would need to happen is that if IGBs were to be reformed, and if we talked about that direct allocation point, we would need to gain Section 33 status as a VAT body to have a full recovery model. We have done early engagement with HM Treasury to understand sort of their viewpoint, to introduce the changes we're looking to make. That will be an ongoing process. So again, but to the co-design point, as that's worked through and we understand the final sort of format of integration joint boards or what they may become, we'll keep abreast of that from a VAT perspective. But where we're clear on the boundaries we have around what would trigger a VAT liability or not, and we're having very early discussions with Treasury around that.
That was originally, I think, estimated to be around about 32 million. Is that correct?
In the initial 2014 bill, so we would expect with inflation and increased costs in care for it to be between 50 and 80 million potential liability.
50 and 80 million liability, yes. Subject obviously to discussion for the HMRC.
If we were to not be able to get a Section 33 body, but we don't consider that would be the option we would take.
50 to 80 million. Okay, thanks very much. And just, I mean, just a kind of point. I mean, a lot of the correspondence between the committee and yourself, Minister, has been around lack of available data. Obviously, you said you provide more information to this committee, but I mean, the information that was provided was fairly limited. Why wasn't there a kind of at this stage, more information kind of provided if it's available?
I mean, I wasn't Minister at the beginning of this bill, but certainly going forward from now, I'm very keen.
This committee meeting today, obviously, I mean, your colleagues have said that they'll provide further information. We've talked about, obviously, period one and there now. I think you said, did you say four months more of information. Was that not available when the information was requested for this committee meeting?
In terms of the time, and when we sent the letter back in July, we had the period one figures at that point, so we now have the period four. So absolutely, we've split it by year and by category in terms of staff and non-staff and some subcategories there. We have a range of subcategories we can split it into, so we're happy to drill down into that.
I suppose, to put on record, we are keen to work with you. So whatever information you want, and those letters back and forth are very helpful, we will try to furnish you with the information that you need to scrutinise this bill, because we want this bill to be the best it can possibly be.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thanks very much. That's concluded questions from the committee, but just one or two from myself just to wind up. I mean, I assumed that period one meant quarter one, and I know other members of the committee thought that as well. If it just means April, why doesn't it just say April? I mean, we're talking about transparency. I mean, that's a pretty basic thing. You know, period one, you know, I mean, just put April, you know, 2024, you know, and instead of period four, that would be July, that would be. So, I mean, I think we all need to talk in simple, straightforward language if we're going to be talking the language of transparency. But the question I was going to ask really was, we've talked about this being a framework bill and there's been much discussion about primary and secondary legislation. And given the changes that we've seen in the evolution of the bill in recent months, where has the balance shifted between primary and secondary legislation? So is the bulk of it now going to be in primary or in secondary? Where has that moved over the last few months?
I mean, I don't know, Donna, if you have a longer term view than I do. It is still a framework bill, so I'd still expect it to be, you know, we're still expecting the detail to be in the secondary legislation. But
I mean, the balance may shift slightly, but certainly the nature of the bill and its framework nature remains. there may be, and we're still working through this with colleagues from COSLA, the NHS and more broadly, there may be some more detail in the primary legislation, specifically, for example, on the National Board, which doesn't appear there at all at the moment. But I think going back to the original principles around flexibility that the former minister set out, the ability to be more agile in the development and the iteration of the National Care Service. Ms Todd's already referenced the multiple changes that have occurred over the lifetime of the NHS, for example. So I think those premises still remain, and we would expect the balance to be probably about the same, but we are not at the point where we have concluded that.
To be the same, so what is that? Is it 30, 70, 20, 80, 40, 60? What are we talking about?
We've still to work through the secondary legislation. As you can see from the current construction of the bill, it is high level. The detail will be set out from the discussions with COSLA, from the discussions with the NHS, and from the co-design process. So I can't give you a percentage at this point in time.
Well, I hope we'll be able to have some more detail on that when the financial memorandum, because I'm not expecting you to say 63.5%, but if it's two-thirds or a half, it would be helpful to know those kind of ballpark kind of shares that we're talking about. Okay, well, thank you very much. I appreciate the time given by the Minister and our officials this morning. And in order to prepare for the next session, we'll have a wee break until 10:40. on our agenda is to continue to get evidence on the sustainability of Scotland's finances as part of a pre-budget scrutiny this year. I welcome to the meeting Rachel Cook, Deputy Head of Policy, Federation of Small Businesses Scotland, Sandy Begbie, CBE, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Financial Enterprise, and Louise McLean, Business Development Director, Signature Pubs, Scottish Hospitality Group. I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session, and if witnesses want to come in and be brought into discussion at any point, please indicate to either myself or the clerks, and I'll call you. So you don't all have to answer every question, but if you do, if I'm asking one to one individual, just feel free to say that you wish to comment. Okay, we have submissions, so we'll just go straight to questions, and of course I'll open out first of all. So, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, who am I going to ask first? Okay, well let's look at FSB. The FSB and indeed Hospitality Scotland has talked a lot about the issue of support for businesses, and I think that's obviously of fundamental importance for your own sector and indeed the Scottish economy. So, for example, first of all, let's see where we are. I mean, the FSB has said that more than half of the businesses who responded to your survey don't feel Scotland is currently an attractive place to start up a business. So two things. One, how does that relate to other parts of the UK or Ireland or anywhere else indeed? Because it's important to get that in context. And secondly, if you can just talk us through what you feel the Scottish Government could do to make Scotland a more attractive place in which to do business. So we'll start with Rachel.
Yeah, of course. Thank you, first of all, for inviting FSB Scotland to today's committee session. We're glad to be here to be talking about the sustainability of Scotland's finances. Particularly on entrepreneurship, we know that new business formation is one of the key drivers of economic growth. High business birth rates drive up levels of innovation, productivity, competitiveness that we want to see post-recovery is particularly. Currently, though, Scotland does have one of the lowest birth rates it's seen for businesses in 11 years, and there are still over 2,300 fewer businesses operating in Scotland currently than there was at the start of the pandemic. So I think that really pulls into picture frame where we're seeing the businesses slip through the net of the economy at the moment. And as you had discussed about the fact that we've seen that more than half of small businesses across Scotland said that they don't feel it's currently an attractive place to start up a business. And more than two-thirds of Scottish small businesses cited the economic uncertainty and the overall cost of living crisis as the main problem at the moment as to why that is the case. So despite that, though, just to be more positive, we have seen that over three-fifths of our SMEs that responded to our survey are hoping to grow within the next 2 years, but current cost of living crisis is going to be one of the biggest barriers to that growth. So I think for us it's important that we don't go unrecognised, the hunger and growth within the small business community. They want to be doing well, they want to expand, they want to invest, and they want to be part of their local economies. But to do that, we are going to need to see support. And as you can see from our submission, we're looking for businesses to not be deprioritised. We understand the fiscal stimulus right now is difficult, and the economic prospects that they're working within and government budgets are very challenging. But there are ways that don't always have price tags to ensure that we are targeting things like entrepreneurship. Just recently, we know there's been a review of the national outcomes, and one area that we've called for within that is that we see a sole focus on entrepreneurship as a national indicator and a national outcome itself, because currently there isn't one that exists. So we aren't really measuring the progress of entrepreneurial nation, despite that being a huge part of the Scottish Government's remit to see a part of their national strategy for economic transformation, to see entrepreneurs. And we're really looking to make sure that, for instance, the £15 million that was put forward as a programme for government for entrepreneurship, we don't really know what that entails yet. So we really want to unpack the detail of where that funding is going to go to make sure that we're removing the practical barriers to entrepreneurship, childcare, flexible working, all those things encompass making it more of an attractive place to start up. We've seen as well, particularly the growth that over 82% of our respondents, 18 to 34-year-olds, were the ones that want to grow in the next 2 years. So there's a younger generation of entrepreneurs coming through, and we need to make sure that that doesn't go untapped potential. And through that, we need to make sure that we're targeting what does entrepreneurial nation actually mean for Scotland. And we need to see that attractive talent, and we need to make sure there's business support in place to make sure that it's not difficult at the moment to start up a business, but overall economic uncertainty, rising inflation, spiralling energy costs is really preventing, I think, from people looking to start up an own business. It's a difficult time. And I think we really need to understand that this budget sets out targets to make sure that specifically spending, but also looking at other ways that we can encourage entrepreneurship in Scotland, as I'm saying, start to make a national indicator that measures those performance targets as well. And also looking to make things a wee bit easier for startups in the current climate through that kind of one-door approach of support, because right now it's quite a cluttered landscape, as we've heard previously. So enterprise agencies and things like that, to make sure we make it more available to people to know what's out there and make it simple and effective.
You didn't answer my question, though, about how Scotland compares to other parts of the United Kingdom with regard to attractiveness and setting up a business.
So in terms of that, I don't currently have the exact statistics on Scotland versus other parts of the United Kingdom as such, but we know from our Small Business Index monitor that business confidence is at a low. We're in negative territory across the entirety of the UK, so it's not Scotland, it's not solely a Scottish issue at the moment, it's across the entirety of the UK economic uncertainty. That's across the board, across FSB in Wales and England and Northern Ireland. So we are seeing that there's been a problem. Our survey that you refer to, that specific stat, is obviously a Scotland-only survey. So the half of respondents that don't think Scotland's an attractive place to start up, I don't have a direct comparison of what entrepreneurs think in England or Northern Ireland, but it's clear to know that I think we know the overall cost of living crisis is affecting that. And I'm happy to get back to the convener to find out what the exact kind of comparison would be.
Okay, and if the FSB had discussions with the Scottish ministers with regard to this £15 million entrepreneurial fund to see how it could be spent, how it should be spent?
Not at the moment. We are looking to kind of have those discussions as we go into kind of now we've just returned from recess. We've obviously got the New Deal for Business group, which we are part of, that we're looking to really have those discussions and get further clarity, and part of the subgroups as well that form that. And the recommendations put forward for the New Deal for Business group is something that we are committed to seeing follow through as well.
Okay, and is £15 million a realistic sum of money? I mean, is it...
It's hard to tell if £15 million is going to be enough. We obviously welcome a cash injection of any type into making sure that we're helping startups to scale ups, but it's really difficult to understand if that's going to be enough, particularly right now where we don't know all the details of what £15 million is going to look like. Is it going to be forms of grant support? Is it going to be for enterprise agencies? We don't know at the moment. So until we start to see that in practice, we're not really sure, but we welcome any additional support to reach Scotland to become an entrepreneurial nation, which is a Scottish Government target. And we are looking to see if, you know, there are other means, as I'm saying, the Small Business Bonus Scheme helps, making sure there's target procurement spending, things like that. There are other ways as well, on top of the cash injection, that can really help set up Scotland to be a more of an attractive place to start a business.
Sandy, startups, etc., etc., where do you stand on issues such as investment of public money in terms of setting up new businesses, supporting innovation, startups, etc.?
So I think, just going back to your first question about investment and also how do we compare with the rest of the UK, quick words just about our sector. So positive side is our sector has regularly outperformed every part of the UK, other than London and South East, for investment into our industry. And that's measured annually by the EY Foreign Direct Investment Survey. So therefore you would argue that it's quite an attractive place to start a business or to invest in a business in financial professional services. The three main reasons that come forward are the strength of the ecosystem, so what already exists, people can plug into quite straightforwardly. Secondly is human capital, so strength of the skill base here in Scotland. And then third is, when you put those together, the cost and quality around it. So if you consider one of the main comparisons is with London, then you've got wage arbitrage about 25-30% benefit for Scotland, and you've obviously got reduced commercial property prices on that, and the quality that you get is of equal quality as you would get elsewhere. So Scotland's financial professional services, compared to the other parts of the UK, you obviously hear a lot about Belfast, Bristol, Manchester, Leeds, etc., we would say is in a strong position. However, when we touch on maybe later the ongoing piece around actually the relationship with public finances and actually these areas of strengths that we need to invest in, I think your broader question around startups and scale-ups, I think, to be honest, we... But to echo what was already said, we do a banking barometer. NatWest produced their regular survey. Confidence in small businesses is low at the moment. I think generally the economy is, as we know, is not growing particularly strongly. And what we do see is while we do have a reasonably strong performance in start-up businesses coming out of the university sector, for example, we fail to convert those at the rate that we should be into start-up scale-ups, into bigger businesses. So we're not performing as strongly in that space as we need to be.
I have to say, I mean, I attended your reception actually just a couple of weeks ago in the garden lobby, which you spoke, Sandy, and what was interesting was that BlackRock pointed out that they're going to increase their workforce in Edinburgh from 1,000 to 1,500. It's 13% of Edinburgh's workforce, but 30% actually of the economy, if you like. So financial services punches well above its weight, which I thought was very interesting. And if obviously BlackRock are employing another 500 people, and we know that they manage some 10 trillion or whatever it is, if memory serves me, of funds. I mean, the base is very strong, but it's about trying to ensure that we continue to maintain that competitive advantage. So, well, it's important to have start-ups and to support innovation, with new businesses, and certainly at Rachel's end, it's also important to ensure that the larger businesses are also continue to grow and thrive. Is that the situation?
Yes, I mean, I think, we'll be the first to admit, I mean, start-up, scale-ups, entrepreneurship has got to be part of the future of the Scottish economy. But we probably have a handful of businesses at scale in terms of, as we sit here today, in terms of that contribution to the economy that, given the position, which is well documented around public finances, our ability to, in the next few years, to be able to support and scale those businesses further, I think it's got to be a real key part of that economic strategy. You know, we employ about 150,000 people in Scotland, and you know, almost 10% of GVA, almost 15 billion exports and 9 billion. So, it's important that the whole economy benefits. But actually, your point about, for example, how do you generate more economic growth in the relatively short term? Then it's going to come from some of those existing larger sectors as we continue to grow other sectors, space, etc., in parallel with that.
Now, Louise, the share of the economy from hospitality is smaller, but in terms of the number of people employed, it's actually larger. And you've raised a number of concerns about going forward. And you mean you've talked, for example, about non-domestic rates and release there, but I'm not really seeing any pounds, shillings and pence being applied. It's always frustrating for finance when people talk about what needs to be done, but without saying what additional resources should go into, for example, supporting the hospitality sector. So you mentioned a number of areas where it can be supported, but what kind of additional funding is the sector looking for across Scotland, and how would that be financed?
The main thing about hospitality just now is we're on an absolute precipice. I'm sure it hasn't escaped your notice, the number of closures we're having just now. It's never been harder to operate in hospitality. I've been in the industry for far too long. And it is a double whammy. We did feel slightly persecuted during the pandemic. Recovery has been painful. And that recovery isn't showing any signs of getting any better. We are hit with the energy costs. We have extraordinary recruitment challenges. And not only is there a lack of confidence in the business sector, there's also a massive lack of confidence in the consumers, because they're seeing their own pay packets not going as far as it once might have. For hospitality to survive, and I genuinely do mean that word, we would need some form of funding and some form of support. And what we had hoped for is certainly to get a relief on non-domestic rates that will allow our profit margins to fund expansion. And it was almost what Sandy was saying there about, I'm not seeing the new entrepreneurs coming into hospitality. I'm not seeing anybody thinking, this is great, I'm going to put my savings in and open a new business. It's almost like the trade's getting older, but the consumers aren't any older. So how do you stay relevant? I would love to see the new guys coming through, but there is no incentive to do it because it is almost impossible to make money just now. And by making money, I mean breaking even, not making a loss, not going bankrupt.
So the whole purpose of this is to try and present to the Scottish Government a report whereby we say in the next financial year these are the priorities that the Scottish Government should take forward, because we know there's a £1 billion funding gap at this stage. We know that finances are challenging, and it's very easy for witnesses to come along and across all sectors, we've already had this, to say, yeah, you should spend more money in our sector or spend more in our sector, And that doesn't, that's simply not possible unless you raise taxation very significantly, which frankly other witnesses have suggested we do. So what kind of additional reliefs are we talking about? I'm trying to think about, I think the latest figure in rates relief is £693 million. How could that be changed, or how could that be increased? How can that be funded to deliver more for the hospitality sector in Scotland?
Well, after the pandemic, England put in their rate relief, which we didn't benefit from in Scotland. So we would like to see that coming into play. We understand that might cost around £85 million, but that money's come through the Barnett consequentials. So it is in the system, and we would like it.
So what you're basically... So in areas where Scotland has an advantage, so, for example, in terms of the small business bonus scheme, we should pay additional rates relief. But in areas where the UK has an advantage, we should ensure that all Barnett consequentials also go into the sector. So it's a kind of double win for the sector, but that would obviously have impacts on other areas of Scottish budget. So if we were to do that, if that £85 million was to be brought into hospitality and other sectors, where in the Scottish budget should the Scottish Government take that?
I have no idea.
Right.
Okay. Right. I mean, that's certainly not from my understanding what I would be asked for. I'm here to present where we are with hospitality, 200,000 jobs, a massive amount of tax paid through the system, from duty through to income tax, through to corporation tax, everything. So we are, you know, everyone pays their taxes. We want to expand. We want to employ more people. We want to actually support communities by ensuring there is still a hospitality provision there. And I fear that without some form of support, what I've just said will not be possible in the upcoming year.
Okay, so for example, let's not talk about, you know, I can understand witnesses has been reluctant to say where in the Scottish budget it should come from. I mean, you probably don't have the same understanding of the Scottish budget as we do. I mean, why would you? It's not your job to do that, to have that level of understanding. But in terms of the philosophy of the Scottish Government, should it look to try and hold spending, reduce spending, increase spending? And if so, should that be through increased? Should we think about increasing taxation, you know, for example, to provide these additional funding? And if so, I mean, one of the things that Sandy could argue is, you know, that more money spent in his sector will produce greater growth and therefore more taxation, more money for public services. You've heard the figures already: 13% of Edinburgh employment, but 30% of the contribution to the economy, and that's money available for public services. But as you've mentioned, 200,000 people is a lot of people. Many of them are in fragile communities where there's no other employment, etc., and they help bind some of these communities together, particularly in rural areas, in my constituency and many others. So where would you want to pitch to the Scottish Government in terms of, we need this additional funding, this is where we think it should perhaps come from, broadly, taxation, lower spending elsewhere? What kind of?
I don't think we particularly want to see a trade-off. I think the point is that we want to employ more people. There's a massive desire to lift people out of poverty. The hospitality is no longer a poorly paid industry at all. Even the hourly wages for our staff are really, really good. I'm not speaking for the whole industry. I'll speak for Signature. And our staff earn anything between... this is the entry level. We'll earn anything between £13 to £15 an hour, which is really, really good. So, I mean, that's your KP. That's a kitchen porter. That's anyone. So it is... putting more jobs into hospitality, allowing us to expand, allows us to employ more people and hopefully lift more people out of poverty.
I mean, Rachel, one of the things that the STC said when it gave evidence to us is that they don't think the Scottish small business bonus scheme actually necessarily works. They think it's... they've been saying this for years, incidentally, when I was chair of this committee from 2011 to 2016, they had the same argument. I mean, and they're saying that that's money that should perhaps go more directly into public services. I'm just wondering what you would say to that. The other thing they would say is it should be tied to Fair Work if small business bonus money is to be spent. What do you feel about that?
Yeah, so over a third of Scottish SMEs at the moment will maintain some level of small business bonus scheme relief following the recent reforms by the Scottish Government. We believe FSB argued that the small business bonus scheme should be maintained, at least in its current threshold, in order that the scheme remains the most generous of its kind in the UK to help SMEs grow. As we know, SBBS is quite a redistributive measure. You know, rateable values tend to be lower in areas where trading conditions are more difficult. So it's a huge support to allow invaluable and support in local economies. But I just want to first note, before we get into the kind of Fair Work conditionality, that over three-fifths of SMEs currently pay at least the real living wage. Those who do not offer the real living wage as a minimum cite the capacity of a financial barrier to do so. SMEs have also been known to employ people furthest away from the labour market. They've also historically been known to support employment and economic growth in a post-recession economy, and they give back to their local communities and support flexible working. So I think, first of all, we just need to take a step back to remind ourselves today what the value is that small businesses are in Scotland's community. They make up 99% of enterprises in the private sector. They bring £110 billion into the economy, and they employ over 1.2 million people. Any conditionalities that we're thinking of putting on a business at the moment really needs to be taken in mind of what the value is. SBBS, I'd be hesitant to look at it as some form of handout. The small business bonus scheme is a relief for businesses right now. And at the end of the day, businesses at the moment need all the relief they can get. We have pulled away a lot of the safety nets of support. The government have done their best to mitigate the risks of the pandemic. But we know from our survey that most of our respondents cite 2022 as actually just as difficult as 2020, if not more so. And that's because we've seen support wind up that was an injection during the pandemic to help recovery. But now that we're into 2022 and we're in the current economic crisis that we're in, we're really struggling to see where businesses can afford to lose any more support. SBBS is currently that relief that businesses need. To remove that safety net of support could mean hampering and losing more businesses to our economy, which in turn will affect growth. And one of the areas that we're very keen to see that is why we've suggested there be included a small business impact assessment rather than just a business regulatory impact assessment, but one that solely focuses on small businesses, so that if you were considering reshaping, reforming or putting any conditionality of SBBS on, we've done that with a first focus of what that means for SMEs in mind, because currently there isn't a small business impact assessment, and that's in Northern Ireland, and we've seen it in England. We want to see one up here to ensure that anything that we're considering doing to take away or change support to businesses is fully taken account for what that impact might look like. I'd be hesitant to say SBBS is something that we should just remove, particularly in the current climate. We stand to want to maintain it at its current threshold.
Okay, that's absolutely fine. I'm just looking to see that your view on that and the importance that you put on that. I mean, one of the things you've said in your submission is you want a more sensible approach to regulation, but you've not really spelled out what you mean. So what regulation, what regulation do you think hampers small businesses in Scotland that we could look to,
yep,
that's devolved and we could look to try and remove or change or...
Yeah, so that's understandable. So as we've said, our survey did find that over a tenth of small businesses already spend more than 8 hours per week, equivalent to a full working day on regulation. We can see regulatory constraints coming in any kind of shape or form that you know, rateable values come in. They need to make sure they're applying for SBBS. We need to, they can do things like understanding the system that they're working within. So as a current example of regulation that's coming in is the visitor levy. We've spoke to a lot of members, recently done a submission to the consultation to that bill. If that was to come in, there's another burden, particularly the accommodation and hospitality sector itself, and having to work within, having to then apply a levy to their charges. It's not so simple for small businesses that don't have, you know, accounts and bookkeepers. They are the bookkeepers themselves, so they need to be carrying out any changes that government implement. We've seen from things like DRS, when implemented regulation comes forward, businesses have a lot of work to put in towards understanding first what it means and then carrying out in practice. Regulatory pressures like that, short-term lets, visitor levy, DRS, all those things that are coming down the line or have been in the past, do have an impact on businesses' day-to-day operations. And we know historically, we know from statistics, that small businesses don't tend to have a lot of time and capacity, financial resource and time capacity to carry out these sort of tasks. So what we're saying about regulation is it needs to be simple, it needs to be effective. For instance, with the visitor levy, we've said, you know, if that's going to be something that changes across all different local authorities, if you've got a business that works between one local authority and another that has to implement different charging schemes for accommodation providers, that can be quite a complicated system to work within. So all we're arguing for is that simplicity within regulatory frameworks that come into place down the line to ensure that businesses themselves are working within the most simple process and there aren't penalties or any kind of burdens that come as a result if they're not working or not making sense of the jurisdiction that they have to work within. And I think we know through, as I'm saying about that kind of small business impact area, that we want to understand what these sort of regulations mean, because at the moment we don't really fully always appreciate what these levies and introductions of these regulations mean for businesses.
Okay. Sandy, what can we do through this budget to ensure that the Scottish financial sector remains competitive?
So I think it's less, it's less necessarily about funding in terms of support. As an industry, a lot of our players are UK players and global players, and they will make decisions and fund operations as they see fit. So for us, it's about making sure that Scotland continues to be an attractive place to establish business. If you look at the Global Financial Centre Index, which we look at, it's produced twice a year, and if you look at, it's done by cities, if you look at Edinburgh and Glasgow, the two. Positively, Edinburgh is in the top 30, has consistently been in global financial centres anywhere in the world. This index looks at over 160 centres globally. Glasgow has moved up from being in the 80s into the 40s, so significant step up. I mentioned earlier about the reasons why businesses are here. And your BlackRock example, well, they will tell you exactly that, which is, you know, they're adding another 600 jobs over the next couple of years because of the quality of people predominantly and that whole cost and quality angle. Our concern, therefore, is more around about the broader business environment and also making sure that we don't underinvest or take those assets for granted. So if you take human capital, for example, we think that a lot of the reviews that are going on currently, they're going broadly in the right direction, but they need to be implemented. It's important that our education sector aligns with the needs of the economy over the next 5 to 10 years. Skills like data, AI, automation, things like that are going to be in huge demand, not only in our sector, but in other sectors. And we would question whether or not the skills system is set up to deliver against the needs of industry. I think another one is around infrastructure. You know, it's the one on the Global Financial Centre Index that Edinburgh and Glasgow don't score as well on. So infrastructure is around things like connectivity. It's around connection with other parts of the world. It's about being able to travel around all that infrastructure that we know. And other cities around the world are bluntly better in that area than we are. So on the basis you can't be great at everything, we do have assets, but we need to keep investing in them. I think also it's important that, because you've touched on tax, I think it's important that we continue to be competitive, not only with the rest of the UK, but across globally. You can't just look through that one lens, which is just absolute tax. It's also about what businesses then get in return for that and the ability to attract people here. So it's important that we keep a rounded debate around that, but everything's got its tipping point in some regards. So for me, it's not about necessarily the our industry needs from government in terms of funding. It's more about the broader business environment and making sure that we continue to be competitive.
So in terms of taxation with regard to that broader, what is the tipping point you've referred to?
So I think we look at tax not only from a Scottish perspective, but a UK perspective. So, you know, we've called out the fact that the corporation tax changes puts us, we think, at a disadvantage. You have seen firms that have chosen to move elsewhere. Citibank is a good example, building their European head office in Dublin rather than in London. Part of that is corporation tax related. So you've got examples of where that's driven investment elsewhere. I think as it relates to Scotland, I think obviously we do have divergence in income tax and obviously land and buildings tax. We do know from some of our larger members that is creating some challenges internally about moving people to Scotland. There's little evidence that people are leaving Scotland. But given what you've seen in some of the submissions and some of the demographic challenges, bluntly, it's that young professional population, 25 to 35-year-olds, who may be based in Leeds or Manchester, maybe work with, you know, big consultancy firms or whatever, are questioning why would they come to Scotland for 5 years, especially when they've only been asked to be in the office 2 or 3 days a week. And part of that's because of paying increased tax and increased tax for buying a property. So those are live conversations, and I could give you a list of 20 or 25 firms that are having that. And that's exactly the type of population we want to attract to Scotland. And, you know, so we should be doing everything we can to attract them. And bluntly, you know, free university prescriptions, etc., they're all great. But for that population, they don't really mean anything. They don't carry any value.
That's very helpful. And just the last question to yourself, please, before I open up to colleagues, which is, you've talked about business rates, for example, and the need to perhaps look again at those in terms of supporting the hospitality sector. That's obviously a blunt tool, although a welcome one, release. But what other help can the Scottish Government provide to help grow and ensure the survival, long-term survival and prosperity of the hospitality sector?
It's encouraging the next group coming forward. If there was young 25-year-olds coming into the city and coming into the sector, then we can make it an attractive place to do business. And that is what hospitality venues are. I mean, yes, they provide infrastructure into a community, but ultimately they are businesses, and they are there to drive expansion. And then to be successful is such a measure that's hard to quantify. But for a lot of people, it's about how many people we employ. And we're very, very proud of that. And that we're very proud of the number of people we've managed to employ through the hospitality sector. If we can do more and more of that and have a thriving hospitality sector, which we used to be famous for. I mean, there's numerous songs about Scotland's hospitality, and I think we've lost that. I think we lost that during the pandemic, and I don't think we have a thriving hospitality industry anymore. I think it's bordering on surviving. I would like to see it flourishing, and that would be massive endorsement from our government that this is an industry that they want to protect and they want to nurture. And that's kind of what the ask is. Can we nurture hospitality to allow it to develop again? Because it hasn't developed in any way now for 4 years.
Okay, thank you. I think we would all agree we need a lot more 25-year-olds in Scotland. In our working population. Okay, I'm going to open it up now. Ross to be followed by Michelle.
I think we could do with more 25-year-olds in Parliament as well. I'm interested just in the first instance on some of the questions around the small business bonus scheme. Rachel, I'd be interested in your point of view on this. I mean, is there not a credibility issue with the small business bonus scheme insofar as it's not just small businesses who get it? There are shooting estates owned in tax havens, owned by billionaires, that are receiving a tax relief that is, at least in terms of its name, supposed to be for small businesses. You know, I think we lose, there's £5 to £10 million every year in small business bonus scheme relief that goes to shooting estates. Surely the FSB agrees that there needs to be some reform of the system so that a tax relief designed for small businesses only goes to small businesses.
Yeah, I think that point is valid. As with any system that comes in, particularly around tax relief for tax systems, there's always some form of issue with it that needs to be reformed. We're all for reforming whatever support is in there. We want the support to be directly to small businesses, and I think that kind of negative side of perhaps the SPBS that you're talking about there is valid in the sense that we don't want to see that either. We would like to see SPBS directed to the smallest and micro of businesses that make up most of Scotland's private sector economy and, as I've said previously, employ and give back to the communities. And that's where we want to see SBS being used for good towards growth. And as I've said, I can't stress enough, although there might be a select number that are somewhat abusive of the relief itself, most of it comes to our members, and the members that we're dealing with are small and micro medium-sized enterprises who heavily rely on the support to keep their communities going. It's people on the high streets that are looking for that small business bonus relief. We talk about death of the high street, we talk about 20-minute neighbourhoods, reviving town centres. That has to go hand in hand with schemes like that to be introduced to ensure that small businesses are getting the best benefit from that to give back to the smaller communities and local economies.
Thanks, that was useful. And just to check, you also mentioned the visitor levy as an example of additional regulation. Can I just check on that? Is your issue with it in terms of how it's implemented rather than the principle of the levy itself, or do you, is the FSP's position in opposition to a visitor levy at all?
Oh, so I think we can see from, we submitted a consultation response to this just about 2 weeks ago. Our small business base is obviously very diverse. It's not a monolith. We have diverse opinions on how people feel about it, but generally we welcome the levy coming in place. Our standing is there's little detail at the moment in the bill of how that's going to look like in practice, how it's going to be implemented. There's also discussions about a flat cap rate versus a percentage charge, things like that. We need to understand what that's going to look like for our members. So we're not opposed to that. We just want to make sure there's more detail in what it's going to come around to and how it's going to look like in reality, and to ensure that it doesn't have a negative adverse impact on our businesses. So one of the examples is the BRIA carried out. We're concerned that VAT, for instance, this could bring some of our small business members over the VAT threshold. But when the BRIA was carried out, you know, only less than two businesses under the threshold of 85,000 were actually consulted upon. So we're concerned that there hasn't been enough of a picture. And because VAT is fiendishly complicated and it's a reserved issue, there wasn't kind of a cost impact associated with that. But we are concerned when the levy comes in place, what that might mean for incurring an additional charge onto our members who are currently sitting below the VAT threshold. They could be brought into that. And that's why a long-standing request of ours to the UK government is to increase the threshold to make sure that it can cushion some of the blows of things like this for our smallest of businesses.
Great, thank you. And Louise, you mentioned in the context of potential additional non-domestic rates relief, in fact, you mentioned signature groups kind of minimum wages of £13-15 an hour, which sounds really positive. And I presume that's regardless of age, that's a starting salary, whatever the age of the worker would be. I'm interested, though, in your written submission, I think you mentioned it in your evidence just a moment ago, includes an argument that additional non-domestic rates relief for the sector would be effective at tackling poverty and low pay. I presume, given that, the hospitality group would be relaxed if an additional relief was brought in, that it was conditional on businesses paying at least the real living wage, regardless of age.
That certainly is absolutely up for discussion. I think it depends how that real living wage is going to be made up, right? So does it include tips? Does it include service charge? What does it include? So yeah, absolutely welcome a wider discussion on that once we've got the parameters of it.
But why should it include tips? I mean, tips are something that workers receive directly at the discretion of the customers. It's the employer's responsibility to make sure for them to pay their staff directly, in this case, at least a wage they can live on. So I don't get why, administratively, I can't see how you would, but regardless of that, in principle, I can't see why you would bring tips into it. Surely, if a business is going to pay its staff at least a livable wage, it's on them to pay their staff at least a livable wage, not rely on the discretion of customers.
A lot of people use a tronc system. So tronc is a service charge which we have no control over. We brought that policy in. So we have a 10% service charge, agreed, discretionary, on everything. We brought that in as a policy that goes 100% to our employees. So what would be great is to see more and more businesses doing something like that, which raises the money per hour going to every single member of staff. That's front of house, that's back of house, that's everyone. So it would come down to economics, I guess, that if there was a case that it had to be the real living wage, there would probably have to be some form of another price rise for the consumer. And we're now up at three price rises a year. There's a ceiling for what people will spend on fish and chips. There's a ceiling for what people will pay for a burger. So it's a bigger equation than just a trade-off of real living wage and non-domestic rates. It's understanding the wider picture of what we're trying to achieve. We all want to see people getting a good wage, and that's why we brought in service charge. And I would say 1 in 1,000 people object to it, and it's probably when they haven't had very good service, and that happens. But it's discretionary, it can be taken off. But every single one of our staff love the fact we brought it in.
On that point of the wider picture, not just seeing the trade-off between those two things, I think you accept, though, that low wages, wages below the real living wage, have a cost both to the public purse but also to the wider economy. Obviously, a worker who's on below the living wage is not going to have much discretionary spending power themselves. There's not much they can spend on fish and chips on a Friday night.
No, I agree with that, and if everyone in this room had a magic wand, we wouldn't be here. But we have to accept what we're playing with and how the cake is made up, and however way we cut it, what we want to be able to do is fund expansion and fund recovery of our trade. And yeah, we'd love to see nobody in poverty. And I think hospitality has made great strides in what we've done to actually elevate how people view the industry. I need more people coming into it because we've got the largest recruitment gap per 100. You know, so it's still not seen as that attractive. So we've got a lot of work to do with that, and we have done a lot of work. But now we really are talking about survival. And I can't see how a lot of businesses are going to be able to survive without it.
So I completely appreciate the difficulties that the sector is under. And yeah, this is a question of survival for some businesses. It's a very literal question of survival, though, for workers who are being paid a poverty wage. And part of the challenge that we have as a committee and that Parliament has overall is really compelling asks are made of us for further expansion of the social security system. You know, there's no reason why in a country as rich as this, one in five children should be in poverty. We spent £450 million-ish on the Scottish Child Payment, so lifted 90,000 children out of poverty. There's hundreds of thousands more children that we could lift out of poverty if we spent more money on that. That money needs to come from somewhere. That largely comes from tax. Income tax is the biggest tax lever that we've got. But Scotland has, relative to the UK as a whole, relative to London South East certainly, a low-wage economy. So one of the ways in which we can tackle poverty both directly at source but also raise additional tax revenue that we can spend on direct interventions is by boosting wages. And the challenge I'm seeing, particularly when I look at media coverage, I believe off the back of a question that Liz asked that's just been answered by Tom Arthur, where the government floats the idea of additional conditionality to existing, potentially, to existing non-domestic rates relief around the living wage. There's comments in the press yesterday and today, I believe, from the Scottish Hospitality Group objecting to that. And I'm really struggling to square the circle here of business sectors who are coming to Parliament making a perfectly compelling and legitimate case for more spending in their area, for more tax relief in their area, but are not willing to take on the conditions that I think could be reasonably associated with that to tackle these wider structural issues in our economy that also have a very direct impact on people's lives. I mean, should it not be really straightforward just to say, yeah, you know what, we do want additional tax relief, but we're willing to take additional conditions alongside it to play our part in driving up wages?
I agree there can be additional conditions, but it doesn't work. If it is, at the moment, we pay, so I'm just with my signature hat on, we pay all of our staff the 1042 rate. So that's the over 23 age rate, regardless of how old you are. So if you're 18, you're coming in and you're getting that. On top of that, you then get service charge, which can be anything from another £2 an hour up to £4 an hour. So we are a really, really good employer. The Scottish Hospitality Group, because we represent the independent industry within our sector, most of us are doing that. So if all of our staff are getting a really, really good rate, it is just about the cake. So if we want to ditch service charge, right, pay the real living wage, £10.90, we then have to put our prices up because we've got to balance the book somehow. We took a look at it for signature, and even if there was 50% rate relief, say that would be 500,000. To move our staff would be 424,000 up to the real living wage. So our staff would probably be worse off because we'd have to lose service charge. So our staff are already to move. It would be a backward step for us to go to real living wage because they're already getting more than that. But that's, I mean, I'm just speaking for the members of Scottish Hospitality Group, and not all of them, because everyone's got a different way of running their own business. So that's what I mean. I'm not trying to be difficult. I'm just trying to say there isn't a one-size-fits-all in this room. Wider discussion is needed, and perhaps sort of more for us in the hospitality sector to be more explanatory about how our business is made up, because it's not all straightforward. And, you know, the price rises fluctuate between geographical locations. So, yeah, I would welcome more discussion on this, because it isn't as straightforward as going to go and pay the real living wage because we're kind of already doing more than that for our staff. And there's a lot of other staff benefits to get. You know, there's massive, massive, you know, we do free food on shift. So if you're working, you get a meal free. In January, all of our staff can come and eat in any of our venues for free if they're struggling because they've overspent at Christmas on their credit card. They get staff discounts everywhere. Our, you know, we do offer a massive, massive range of benefits to our staff. And I think maybe that this is the forward thinking. This is the new way of hospitality as opposed to your Pat Butcher with our gin and tonic and ice and a slice and the Queen Vic, you know. And we've moved on so much, and I would welcome the chance to sit down with some of you and explain how much we have moved on and how the welfare of our staff is at the forefront of every single decision we make.
You've made a very compelling case to anybody who's watching and considering our own hospitality for the Signature Group's vacancy page. I've got a couple of other questions, but I'm conscious of time, Convener. Is that okay?
That's one for Sandy, so feel free.
Yes, I didn't want Sandy to feel left out. Interested, Sandy, in your thoughts on whether or not the Scottish Government is getting best value for money from things like grants, public procurement, etc. Quite a lot of public money goes out the door to the private sector every year, entirely necessarily, but is the government doing enough to make sure that the benefits of that stay within the Scottish economy? Naturally, some of that goes towards larger companies, for example, multinationals, etc., and again, unavoidably so. But is the government doing enough through, for example, public procurement mechanisms to make sure that it's maximising the benefits of that to the Scottish economy?
Good question. I'm not sure I can really answer the question specifically. I think what I do hear is, particularly from SMEs and also from, I do a lot in the third sector, is public procurement processes are particularly cumbersome and particularly challenging and don't necessarily always end up with the right outcome. So I think that also you tend to find is that different local authorities will run slightly different procurement processes. So there's an efficiency point in all of that for me. But personally speaking, whilst I've not actually engaged directly in the procurement process, but as I say, I think that it is at times people find it really challenging.
You mentioned the impact on SMEs. I'm conscious Rachel might have something to contribute on that.
Yeah, definitely. On procurement, so our survey just showed that the majority of Scottish SMEs have never tendered for or run any public contracts. Two-thirds of Scottish SMEs have found the process complex and challenging, as Sandy had said. And a lot of them feel that it's geared towards larger businesses, and over half of Scottish SMEs do not believe procurement spend by local authorities and public bodies is currently sufficient with micro and small businesses. So we have seen generally that procurement is really lacking, and it's really a lot of untapped potential that we're not seeing a larger procurement spend with the small businesses. We obviously know that the community wealth building legislation is coming in, and we want to make sure that supports local authorities to spend better with their micro businesses. But we also want to see, we talked about kind of things that don't have price tags on them as part of this reform of sustainability of the finances. Realistically, we could look to be creating a procurement target, a national indicator that sits within a national performance framework, which is, allows us to measure just how many procurement contracts are being won by SMEs. And therefore, if the more we measure that performance, the more we can start to understand why it's geared towards larger businesses, why it's too complex of an area, and how we can simplify that to make it more efficient and have more of that local spend and local economies thriving.
Just so that I'm completely clear on that, is the issue at the moment that we're not even completely clear, we could all probably guess why and have plenty of anecdotal evidence, but we're not completely clear exactly what the barriers within the procurement system are to SMEs, and therefore we need to do that basic data collection first, yeah, before we can come up with policy proposals.
Yeah, I think genuinely, as you're saying, there's a lot of anecdotal. We hear from members, their kind of first-hand experiences. Generally, the system's very complicated. It can be very convoluted to try and work through everything. That for businesses that don't have a lot of capacity or time or the know-how to understand to bid for these contracts that larger businesses do have. So you're definitely right, there needs to be more data. We're all for, you know, as a policy person myself, I'm all for backing and increased data. We know business data is lacking in Scotland. This committee has taken evidence in the past in that it's been spoken about by many organisations, including ourselves, that we need to increase the business data that's out there so we can really address and hone in on the issues that exist for each individual business, because they're not a monolith and it isn't a one-size-fits-all. For procurement and local authorities themselves, each need is different across the board, so we do want to see that improved, both data and kind of performance measurement in those areas.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you, Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Good morning, everybody. We started this conversation with the convener asking about confidence. So just a quick question, first of all, for yourself, Sandy. What do you see as the impact in investor confidence, both in themselves and in other products of your sector, Rishi Sunak's recent U-turn around net zero commitments?
So I think it's a good question. So I think what investors are looking for is a consistent landscape for making investment decisions. So whether that is those decisions, I'm not giving any particular political view on whether they're right or wrong. All it does is create a degree of uncertainty in investors' minds. You've heard some of the reactions from particularly some of the car firms as a good example. I think what's really important for investors is to having the confidence around the business environment in which they're investing in. The more you can do that, the better. And you can see in places like Ireland, for example, where that consistency of business environment is almost transcends even the change in government. And it's things like, again, not political point, but, things like windfall taxes as well creates uncertainty. And you've seen some of that happening in oil and gas, changes in corporation tax, etc. So changes like that, I think, create uncertainty in investors' minds may choose to invest elsewhere.
And to what extent, and if any, despite the protestations of continued focus from the Scottish Government, do you think that will inevitably flow into funding flows given the nature of how that operates out of the city, for example? Do you think that's inevitable, that lack of confidence, and therefore change in funding flows, despite the protestations of the Scottish Government to continue with the path that they've set out?
Yes, it's obviously early days, but it may well do, because capital can flow anywhere in the world. The provision of capital at the moment is not the problem. There is money out there. I think what we consistently hear from investors that we've got our members is around the provision of investable projects. So having those projects that they can invest in. Secondly, is about then the environment in which they can invest in. So things like planning and other things then are supportive of that. Third is around skills. There's actually skills there to then execute on the investment. So those are the things I think that, and I've said this many times, I think those are things that we could usefully in our business environment tighten up on.
And continuing in the theme of confidence, I'm interested in yourself, Rachel, the nature of confidence in your measures of women-led businesses. How is that distinct from male-led businesses, and what's your data telling you?
Yeah, so with our big small business survey that we carried out earlier on this year, it's one of the most extensive surveys that we've actually carried out. It was both for our members and wider SMEs across Scotland for anybody to take part in. And we were really fortunate that we actually got a pretty 50-50 even split across female and male respondents. So we've actually had that gender disaggregated data to have that comparison. When it comes to confidence, we have seen quite a lot of kind of even splits across both male and female owned businesses. Don't feel like Scotland's a great place to start the business. They both genders have felt that the overall economic uncertainty and cost of living crisis, that seems to be a blanket feeling. Where we've seen the real issue with women's led businesses is essentially around they don't tend to tender for procurement contracts at all, as opposed to male-owned businesses, and they don't tend to apply for external finance. And we've seen that obviously we know disproportionately small businesses rely on external finance to help cash flow, investment and expansion. So if we don't have women entrepreneurs looking to apply for that external finance or struggling to get that, then we will see a huge loss in the economy. As you know, there's a lot of data that exists about the fact that if women aren't doing their job in the economy and aren't getting the same equal opportunities, that's really hampering growth. One of the areas we think that could be really beneficial is the Scottish National Investment Bank. We have asked for previously that we would like to see 20% of its annual investment budget targeted toward SMEs. But as part of that, we would really like to see the measuring and publishing of the proportion of loans that are actually given not just to disabled and ethnic minority entrepreneurs who are also less likely to apply for accessible finance, but women themselves. We want to see more women entrepreneurs, and entrepreneurship can be a difficult thing to get into, as we've spoke about, and I'm sure other committees have addressed the issues around childcare, flexible working arrangements. Self-employment, SMEs, they tend to offer more of that option of flexible working and can fit into that childcare arrangement, but it still remains one of the largest barriers into employment opportunities and into entrepreneurship. So when we talk about entering the labour market, it can't just be getting a job, it should also be about creating your own job. It should be about entrepreneurialism and where we can see those barriers being removed. And that's where we want to see women be encouraged to apply for external finance, to start up their own business and to become young entrepreneurs in themselves, but you know, at any point in their life, to be able to support their own dream of having whatever business they want to do. But that's going to come down to the fact that we need to see more access to finance, more cash support provided to women entrepreneurs. But their confidence, I think, in the access to finance is where we're really seeing the issue. And obviously that leads to, as I'm saying, a lack of women becoming entrepreneurs themselves.
And you've actually led me on to my next area. I mean, it struck me that 15 million is a relatively low figure for entrepreneurialism, given, you know, some of the figures that were being bandied about before the 2021 election. In terms of the New Deal for Business, and off the back of a very good report by Mark Logan and Anna Stewart in terms of encouraging female entrepreneurship, I appreciate it's early days, and you said that in your statement earlier, but what sense are you getting about a relentless focus on enabling half of our, in fact, over half of our population? Rachel, I'll come to you first, but I think you may have a view, Sandy, as well.
Yeah, I think you mentioned the report. That's an excellent piece of work that's been carried out that's really started to paint that picture, because I think there has been a bit of, there's not been a lot of clarity on that area, in particular in Scotland. And we know, I think we're aware that small businesses themselves are struggling, but what that means for struggling entrepreneurs is different. And as you're saying, 15 million, as I've said earlier, we welcome any cash injection in any form, particularly in the current climate. We, you know, every penny is a prisoner at the moment, and we need to make sure that we're making the most of that. But I think where we're seeing that lack of support is we're seeing there are institutions and there's levers already there to be pulled. That 15 million is great, but there is the bank sitting there with an annual budget to invest. We need to pull on that lever and maximise its disposal to make sure that there is a target towards women entrepreneurs. And without those targets and measurements getting put in place, I think we're really going to struggle to leverage that part of our economy in itself. And I think that's why we're arguing for the bank itself to be more disproportionately including women in their loans, particularly to micro and small businesses, that it currently doesn't do. So we are looking to really bolster where we can see women coming into entrepreneurship. And I know there isn't going to be a silver bullet to that, because as we're saying, things like childcare is a big area, particularly for women in the workforce, that we need to see provisional hours given, and Programme for Government did make a bigger commitment to that, and we are welcoming of that. That is a huge area that we've heard from a lot of our members, but yeah, particularly women, that childcare is an issue for them.
I appreciate this is a very big area, and you're coming off the back of questions that I myself have asked of SNIB when on the Economy Committee. Sandy, and I want to bring in Louisa as well, in terms of your reflections around a focus on women in your sector. Of course, I'm aware that there's a lot of work that you've done and your stats are different, but I'd like some reflections from you in terms of entrepreneurialism, that sum of money, and particular challenges for women in your sector.
Yeah, I mean, as I think Rachel highlights, you know, that there are lots of other elements of the system that need to be in place to support females into entrepreneurship. I also think, and I've always maintained this, I think that our relatively average performance in entrepreneurship stems in schools. So I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done in schools. You know, if it was up to me, I would put Young Enterprise Scot in every single school, secondary school in Scotland. Because actually you also find that there are young people in schools who may not connect educationally, academically, that actually do really, really well in those type of situations. So I think we need to start further down the track, and actually also then encourage females and others from other minority backgrounds to be involved in entrepreneurship. I think in our area, I think that entrepreneurship is in the fintech space. If Nicola was here, would tell you that there's a lot of females who are involved in that fintech space, so you're starting to see more females coming into that. I contribute to Anna's work at the time, so I think you're starting to see some of that come through. But I think, to Rachel's point, is there needs to be a lot of other parts of the system that are there to support females as they go through, because there are huge benefits. It's already been articulated.
And last question, to give you a chance to come in, Louise, in terms of, I imagine there are very particular challenges for women working in hospitality. And returning to the original theme of this session, in terms of what specifically can the Scottish Government do in your sector? What specifically can the Scottish Government do in your sector for women working in it?
We've got quite young people. You know, it is the nature of the beast is quite young. We've got 50-50 split of general managers, they're women to men, which I'm really proud of, because that wasn't the case it was 10 years ago, and we have really, really pushed on with that. And there's quite a lot of females in our senior team. In fact, I think definitely a higher percentage than men, which is also encouraging. We encourage every single general manager to put through an entrepreneurial shift every single week. It's one of our values, which makes me sound so corporate, and I don't mean it to. But, I mean, it is huge. We want our general managers to treat these businesses as if it were their own. The biggest compliment to me is somebody that goes away and sets up on their own. Someone that's come through our business, takes the leap, and goes up and sets up on their own. And we work really, really hard to encourage that. We pay them every week to put one shift through where they can drive their own desires. That might be competitive research, that might be research and development. We really push it hard. For women in the sector, I think they're very, very well supported. I think we don't really have a gender bias within hospitality, which, again, I'm very, very, very proud of. We are flexible as much as we possibly can be. I think, broadly speaking, being a female hasn't held me back in any way. And I came through the brewing industry, which is very, very male-dominated in the 90s. So, no, I think the female workers in the country are very well supported.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's be followed by John.
Thank you, and thank you very much for the evidence that you've so far provided, which I have to say I think has been very helpful to us. When the Deputy First Minister of the time, John Swinney, was with this committee on the last budget scrutiny, he flagged up three really critical issues, and one of them was entrepreneurship, the second was about regional support and business, but the third one, to which he accredited very considerable importance, was about the numbers of people who are economically inactive, who've come out of the workforce in Scotland, and that was really causing a lot of difficulties. Perhaps that's people who, since COVID, have decided that they no longer want to work full-time. They're only doing part-time. Some of them have come out altogether, taken early retirement. And he was very concerned about how we attract more of these people back in. Could you offer us some suggestions as to what you would like to see in the approach to the economically inactive? There's obviously a waste of talent of not having these people.
Yeah, I would love to see people, certainly older people, they've got skills of life, they know how to talk to people, they're not entitled, they know how to graft. I would love to see more of the older demographic getting back into work. How we do that, I don't know. When I went down to London quite a lot just after the pandemic, I noticed there was a lot of 60 to 70-year-olds serving breakfast shifts in bars and in hotels. I think that is something that would be wonderful to be encouraged. My own mum is 72 and started working in one of our bars yesterday, 9 hours a week cleaning it, because she's bored. And she wants to go and do the brasses, you know? And literally, so she's working in St Andrews now for us. And I think that's absolutely fantastic. Anything we can do about creating, but it's making it attractive enough. And I think it's giving people the confidence. A lot of people, once they're out of work, their confidence takes a real knock. So how do we make it so that actually you're like, guys, this isn't about pulling pints. This is about contributing to your own mental health, your own welfare, and supporting the other businesses. Brilliant opportunity. We'd be delighted to get behind it.
Okay, that's helpful. Sandy?
Yeah. I would just echo what Louise has said. I think there's a piece around data. I mean, Scotland, based on UK numbers, have more percentage inactive than other parts of the UK. So what is driving that? I think that's a be really important. I think secondly for me is about I think employers need to be more open-minded. I think there is something about how all sectors step up. I think there's clearly evidence around particularly people with disabilities, particularly physical disabilities, and employers are too closed in their mind around around different people with who are currently inactive. So I think there's a piece about that, and then I think the third thing is how do you make that attractive? You know, how do you? Because I think there's perceptions about certain industries that people who are inactive might say that's not for me. And therefore, how do you then break down some of those perceptions and encourage people to think about those as viable options? But we need to do something, because I think I remember hearing John saying he reckoned there's about 150,000 people in Scotland who, with not a lot of encouragement, could probably find themselves back in the workplace.
Exactly why I'm asking the question, because he was very strong. In fact, he impressed me by what he said about that. And you know, these are people, as Louise has rightly flagged up, whose skills we desperately need and who've got this wealth of experience. And to try to ensure that they come back into the workforce, I think, is critical. So obviously it's got a productivity angle as well as anything. Rachel, do you have any...
Yeah, I mean, probably not much more than what the other evidence sessions we've said. I think, to be fair, as I've said already, SMEs do tend to hire people furthest away from the labour market. I don't know, statistically speaking, what that would mean in terms of the economically inactive coming into the labour market, but in terms of what SMEs can offer employees, in terms of flexible working, around that kind of community spirit, their local economies. We know in Scotland that we have an ageing population, and we also have an issue in Scotland where a lot of people don't work where they live, and they're commuting out or they're leaving certain local authority areas to get work, particularly in the younger generation. But I think that's also true of the older generation in Scotland, where we're seeing a lot of people, what's on their doorstep. They shouldn't always have to come into the big cities to get jobs. They shouldn't have to come into the more kind of affluent local authority areas that have maybe a thriving high street, as opposed to others that have a more dwindled high street. We have a huge problem where in each area of local authorities have different needs. But how do we inject that life back into our local areas to encourage people to then have a job in their area that they live? And SMEs can play a part in that. But if SMEs close their doors because they don't have support and they're struggling to keep their business afloat, they're not going to be there to offer the labour market opportunities of bringing people back into that workforce. That, again, FSB would be very much involved. We would love to be part of that discussion around how we encourage the over 50s and the economically inactive to come into the labour market, because we know that's an issue that's been raised before. And we definitely think they'd be a key player amongst our small business community in addressing that issue.
Do any of you think there's any sign that there is a slight movement within the economically inactive people who are starting to look at jobs, or is it just a very difficult landscape?
The stats would tell you there's a slight turndown in terms of the numbers of inactive. Listen, to the Bank of England, a lot of that is to do with people who have chosen to take themselves out of the labour market, who have now realised that actually, because of the result of living, cost of living and inflation, etc., actually, they probably need to put themselves back into the labour market to because it's not working out the way that they might have wanted to. So there is a bit of that. But clearly, the long-term ill health angle, there doesn't seem to be a lot of evidence to suggest that that's changing.
Difficult. I wanted to ask also about our high streets, and perhaps, Rachel, you're probably best to answer this, because obviously it is a great concern to many of us who represent particularly rural communities that our high streets and our smaller towns are really decimated. What else do you think we can do to try to reverse that trend?
So I think, just generally speaking, it's hard to... There's probably not a... You know, hard to give a kind of one answer to that, probably, you know, one solution to that. I think it depends, as we've spoke about, local authorities having different needs. I think that needs to be addressed with small businesses as well. What works for businesses, as we know from our own data and other data for rural businesses, doesn't necessarily work for urban. And we need to really see that, because a lot of our survey findings showed that a lot of our businesses said that support isn't always recognised and the different needs of what businesses. So rather than treating them as a monolith, we need to start really looking and digging down deep into the data that we can gather and general information around what it means for businesses in certain areas of Scotland, what are their challenges demographically and geographically that they don't all have in common. And I think trying to get more data would be a start on that area, but I think going forward we need to see that support for businesses. We're talking about the visitor levy again as another area that we're generally broadly supportive of, but if that means that it becomes more difficult for one local authority and it's a competitive disadvantage, then that's going to become an issue, and we're going to start to see more of that divergence between local authority areas and businesses in their local high streets. So we need to see a lot more of that kind of simple and effective approach to understanding what businesses need. We need to see small business impact assessments. And I think another area is just that round of that support. The small business bonus scheme we've already touched on, that's a huge reach relief, particularly for areas where there are, you know, we are seeing those businesses are struggling on the high street. SBBS is something, if that was to be taken away or changed in any way, that could close further doors on a local high street that we don't want to see. So it's maintaining the support that's there, not cutting it, not deprioritising, but also just starting to refine what support we provide for each area and how that looks in economic partnerships. Economic development is a huge thing. And at FSB, we have development managers who work across different regions of Scotland, and we continuously hear they all have very different issues coming to their doorsteps of their businesses in that area. If Clackman and Shire Council have just shut facilities on their high street or put in parking charges, that's going to be a problem for that area alone. So we need to make sure that we're aware of what different local authorities are putting in their local areas to make sure that we aren't causing these competitive disadvantage or a bit of a postcode lottery when it comes to if a high street's going to survive or not.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Joined to be followed by Jamie.
Thank you very much, convener. Maybe starting with hospitality, Ms McLean, you kind of indicated that the sector is struggling, and I just wonder if that varies geographically, because in Edinburgh it seems to me that hotel prices are quite high and that indicates there's a lot of demand. Last September I could fairly easily get a hotel for a night for less than £100. Now I couldn't find one this September for less than £100, and some of them are not that fancy hotels, I would have to say. So is it patchy around the country? Presumably we don't need to support hotels in Edinburgh.
So in terms of what we are saying, no, there's geographically, no. There's so many different ways that that a business is profitable in hospitality. So we've got venues in Aberdeen, St Andrews, Glasgow, Edinburgh. Bizarrely, our most successful venues just now are in Glasgow. You know, Edinburgh is very, very hard to operate in. There's a lot of hotels, and a lot of hotels. I mean, I can only speak for ourselves that we've seen rates go up, but we've seen occupancy drop. So what we're seeing is weekend trade. So what if you've got your desired take for a week, for example, of what you're forecasting, it's all at the weekend. There's very, very little occupancy during the week. So
the hotel would not have me stay than take a lower price.
No, we'd love you to stay on a Monday when there's...
Stay on a Tuesday and a Wednesday, and it's still over £100.
I think £100 is pretty fair.
Well, I've just booked Aberdeen at 60.
Good, great. No, there's a huge difference between it. When the oil and gas was flying, Aberdeen was really, really, really expensive to stay in. It is just down to demand. And, you know, you're absolutely right that rates in Edinburgh have definitely, definitely gone up, but that doesn't correlate straight through to profitability, I'm afraid.
That's a lot more than inflation, though. Okay. If I could move on, Mr. Begbie. Now, you suggested that perhaps higher taxes is discouraging younger people from coming here, and you also, I think, said that infrastructure here could do to be improved, by which I assume you mean trams and trains and things like that. So how do we square that? Because the obvious way of improving infrastructure is to put more tax into that, but then that puts people off. So what's your thinking?
Not necessarily. You know, infrastructure is a long-term investment. You know, I'm not familiar with reserved and devolved in detail, but, you know, some of these longer-term investment projects, you know, you have industries like, for example, the pensions industry and others who would quite gladly look at long-term 20, 30-year investments, whether that's through bonds or some other vehicle, in order to support infrastructure investment. So it doesn't naturally need to come from... It's about how do you attract capital to infrastructure projects. I think that's a live discussion. I think it's really important that we have that conversation. Because I said earlier, capital is not the challenge. You know, if there's a compelling proposition, whether it's around the just transition or whether it's around infrastructure or whatever, then actually, if there's an investable project, then the capital will come and we'll find that. So it's not It's not a tax
issue. Would that be kind of down the PFI route then?
Down what, sir?
PFI, Public Finance Initiative. I mean, that we would end up paying a lot more in the long run. If it's not from tax.
Not necessarily, I would have said. I mean, at the end of the day, it's a, you know, you could, say, if you take Edinburgh Airport, for example, right? Edinburgh Airport is obviously a privately owned asset. Edinburgh Airport is arguably going to be, you know, it's at capacity, you know, so it's an important gateway, as is Glasgow. So you've got privately owned assets already, which need to attract more inward investment. Some of it could be public, but some of it could be private as well.
So what's stopping the Edinburgh, just take that example, seeing you've given it, what's stopping Edinburgh Airport expanding?
Public planning and other things. I suspect you've got environmental impacts and various other things. So I think that's a much broader canvas. I'm just making the point is that you'll have privately owned assets that actually would attract private capital, and then you'll have public projects that will attract private capital, and et cetera. But you're right, even if it's a public-owned asset, then to attract private capital, then there will need to be a return for that money at some point, because the money could go anywhere in the world.
I mean, I think you suggested in one of the papers that we should have a discussion on tax and spending, and I think that's, I very much agree with that. Because I think that there's been a kind of public thinking, I think Scotland and the UK, that we want lower taxes and we want better public services. And I just feel there's a tension in there. Do you think it's possible to have that kind of public debate with the wider public, or even with your sector?
So, yes, I mean, I think we need to have that debate, because I think, I mean, one thing we've not touched on here is the point about the tax base versus the tax take. So I think that you know, you've got a, and the convener asked earlier, you know, you've got there's a challenge in the public finances. You've got costs and you've got revenue. In the medium to long term, that revenue line needs to come from increasing the size of the tax base, which means we have got opportunities in Scotland through our growth industries to have well-paid, high-paid jobs, which will pay more tax, which will then be able to fund the public services. And then the secondary economy, like hospitality, etc., should benefit on the back of that. There's lots of examples around the world of other economies and other cities. I've only got experience in Melbourne because my youngest daughter's there at the moment, where she works in hospitality and she gets paid double what you pay in Scotland. And the reason being is because it's a higher wage, higher skilled economy. It's possible to do it. So we need to look at ways in which we increase the size of the tax base, is what we've always called out, not necessarily the tax take.
For people that don't understand the term tax base, could you just explain what you mean by that?
You have more people paying. So the average wage in Scotland is about 29,000, as I understand at the moment. We as an industry pay about 40,000, just over as an average wage. So if we've got industries that are paying higher than the average wage, obviously the more jobs we add in that pay above that average wage, then you're going to increase the size of the tax base, both in terms of numbers, but also then your actual financial take.
Okay. Ms Cook, the idea of a debate about, you know, and especially for small businesses, would they rather have pay more tax, more rates, and get better road surfaces, better street lighting, more police, better hospitals, or would they rather have drop the domestic rates and other tax and have poorer services? Is that a debate we can have?
I think it's certainly a debate we should be having. We cry out all the time that we want government to engage with businesses, so we really want to see SMEs being spoken to directly through government and through local authorities to understand what they want and where they want it. FSB, as ourselves, we can only get a snippet of what we see, but as an example, the visitor levy coming in, businesses are happy for that to come in, and when we asked where they would want to see that money, most of them said infrastructure. So they're happy for a levy to be introduced and for that to, as long as it doesn't discourage tourism, which I think a lot of statistics and the data and kind of illustrated that they wouldn't. But we would want to make sure that that money just doesn't go into, you know, putting pennies into what is a declining budget for local authorities to go towards other things. We want to see a direct correlation of where the spending goes that makes an impact and a difference for businesses in their area. So we don't want to just see, because we know that local authorities are struggling right now, if we introduce a visitor levy, we don't want to see that funds being put down to help the debt or any other areas local authorities are kind of putting that. We want to see it kind of more ring-fenced funding to ensure that we see that impact, which we know the visitor levy bill is looking to do, which we encourage because businesses like ourselves and our members, they want to see infrastructure spend, they want to see better facilities. I don't think it's easy to say that, you know, we know that, as I've spoke about previously, there are geographical changes. What works and what is needed in one area of council might not be needed in another. Rural businesses have more of an issue in terms of road maintenance not being great. That's not necessarily the same for another council area. So we do want to make sure that we're seeing, you know, we don't know exactly what businesses would like to see, but they want to make sure that any spending is directly correlated so that if there is taxes put in place, that they see value for their money.
And would that be your view, Ms McLean, as well?
Yeah, I'm broadly supportive of the visitor levy as long as it's spent in the right way. I'd love to see it anything to do enhancing the public realm, enhancing the infrastructure. That's all makes sense to me.
The wider issue of having a debate as to do we want Scotland to be a country with higher taxes and better public services or lower taxes and poorer public services?
Oh, I think debate's healthy. Absolutely fantastic. Yeah, if the more engagement, the better. Sounds like quite a grown-up way of approaching it.
That's good. OK. On a separate point, we also look at public sector reform here, and one of the suggestions has been that there are too many public bodies. There's a cluttered landscape. So I'd like to ask each of you, obviously you're going to reflect it from your sector, but are there too many public bodies? Is the landscape too cluttered? Again, Mr. Beckwith.
Yes. I wear a variety of hats in this space. You know, I'm chair of DYW and the work in the Young Persons Guarantee, etc. I mean, the public sector landscape is unbelievably complicated. You know,
two bodies we could drop.
I could give you a list. But in all seriousness, I mean, okay, if you take, for example, you know, we've got three development agencies, enterprise agencies in Scotland, right? We've got a population of 5.7 million people. As I always say, we're a medium-sized Chinese city, you know, in population terms. We don't need that level of oversight and involvement. You know, we've got 32 local authorities. I know no one in this room would probably want to take it on, but we don't need 32 local authorities. You know, so we have got layers upon layers upon layers of complexity in Scotland, and public sector reform, I think, has got to be part of this, as well as actually how does business also, how do we grow the economy sustainably and grow it in a way that it takes forward a lot of what government's talking about, wellbeing, economy, just transition, etc. But we need a holistic approach on this. But public sector reform's got to be part of it.
Ms McLean?
What he said.
You agree with that?
Yeah, it's not something I've ever really considered, but anything that could take away the complexity of doing business in Scotland would definitely be appreciated.
I mean, one of the examples you gave earlier was that your sector, you're having to deal with different councils with different rules.
Yeah.
On the other hand, people would say, well, the situation in Highlands is different from Edinburgh and Aberdeen and so on.
I mean, I can only speak about it during the pandemic. We were having a really hard time dealing with when we were looking at, I can't remember what it was, but we almost had to say, can you know, this is the same company, we operate in different areas, can we just have one person to talk to? And so, yeah, like you say, just we are Scotland, and yes, there are nuances across the country, but removing layers of complexity would definitely be appreciated.
I mean, not to go on too long, but I mean, would you say on the whole, some people said COVID was a good experience because things happened quicker and the public sector worked better. Other people said that there was too many decisions made without consultation. Did you have a good or a bad experience through COVID?
Bad.
Bad. Right, thank you. Okay. Ms Cook, back to the previous question.
Yeah.
Is the public sector too cluttered?
It definitely is. The cluttered landscape of business support, we've spoken about it before and today, and I'm probably not saying anything that my colleagues haven't said this morning. We want to see that one-door approach for businesses to get support. At the moment, it's cluttered, it's confusing. More and more regulations, if we spoke about STL, the visitor levy, DRS, alcohol consultation, these things get flagged up to our members. It's a bit of a red flag at times because they suddenly panic and they don't know what impact this is going to have on their business. the message isn't always clear. It can be quite complicated. It's coming from different governing bodies, different local authorities, and we agree with the not the one size fits all, but we're always asking for simplicity. So things like a visitor levy comes in place. That needs to be a simple system. If
so would you rather that's a national thing rather than a local thing?
No, we agree for it to be local. We just want to be there's some form of accountability and there's a simplicity in the processes that are put in. So, you know, we want to make sure that whatever we had argued that there sort of be a national cap, for instance, to ensure that as much as we've got that difference of approach and each local authority has their own approach to what they want to charge, we don't see any competitive disadvantage or any adverse effects happening across neighbouring local authority areas. So it's a tricky balance, and I don't have the answers to how we make sure we fit that kind of... we don't treat everything as a monolith, but we also make sure that we have flexibility in the system. It is difficult, but one that I think through discussion and public sector reform we could get better at.
Thanks so much. Thanks, Camino.
Thanks very much. We didn't even go on to integrated joint boards, community planning partnerships and regional and city deals. And I would disagree with Mr Begbie. I certainly would take on these reforms. I mean, I think in Ayrshire, three Ayrshire councils and a health board, why not have one structure? And that's certainly been my view, which I've expressed probably over a number of years. Jamie, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks very much. I mean, I get the points made about this, but then you have to go to people in the Highlands and Islands and say to them, yeah, more power needs to be in Edinburgh, and that's not an argument anybody wants to make. And in fact, even if you're in the Highland area, Inverness is seen as the great kind of collector of power. So it's a really difficult balance. I just wanted to come back to the point, actually, Rachel, you were making around the rural aspect, and I was just going to ask, you've talked about business confidence in Scotland being low across the UK, but in Scotland was your where you were kind of focused. I was just wondering whether there's a regional differences as well. I mean, Highlands and Islands is the area I represent. Small businesses are absolutely vital, lifeblood of the communities right across the region and the islands and the rural parts of the Highlands. So I was just wondering if you could tell me whether there's any difference between business confidence there and in other parts of Scotland.
Yeah, definitely. So as I've said, we have found through our members that the general approach is everybody's concerned about the overall economic uncertainty and the cost of living crisis that doesn't seem to have any geographical divergence. But we are seeing in the rural areas, you know, that is, as you're saying, it's an economy itself that relies heavily on like hospitality and accommodation sector. That is an area that had borne the brunt of challenges during the pandemic. We've seen most of them struggle through that time. They're still struggling. They're the ones that have also faced the spiral in energy costs has been particularly prevalent as an issue for those members in the accommodation, hospitality and tourism. For rural businesses, we are seeing that lack of confidence because of the sector that they're working within. There has been a lot of divergence in our survey where we've seen rural businesses have more specific needs when it comes to things like lack of appropriately skilled staff. Finding available local workers is a real issue for rural businesses at the moment. Retaining and recruiting staff is becoming a real issue, and it's one that we're seeing, again, more dominant in the rural areas of Scotland than it is in the kind of urban, more central belt. So that's where we really need to understand those business needs up there differ greatly. That's why the Scottish Government's plan to probably introduce different immigration pilot schemes and things like that for workers for rural areas we are on board with, but again, we need to make sure that that's completely explicit in mind with what SMEs are looking for, not just a broad brush approach that will they need more workers up there. You know, there's not going to be a silver bullet for that. There needs to be an impact assessment carried out on what exactly it is so that any solution brought forward does keep rural small businesses in mind and at the forefront the entire time.
It's about infrastructure as well, and obviously we've seen uncertainty over the A9. We've seen a disastrous summer really for a lot of island communities because of ferries. Even some of the ferries which operate within the Highland, the mainland of the Highland, the Corran ferry particularly has been out. I was meeting with people on the Ardmurchan Peninsula that wondering whether they could keep on with their businesses. How do you get that message across to government, both at ministerial level, but within, so that the influence of kind of budget decisions, that, you know, infrastructure, particularly transport infrastructure, is absolutely vital?
Yeah, it's a difficult challenge, and one, as you're saying, is very niche to the area. When we did carry out the kind of transport chapter of our survey, a lot of the rural respondents had mentioned the ferry issue has been a huge problem for their business base. So I think for us, we've always argued that transport needs to be affordable, accessible and reliable. And currently, in its current format, and what our members have been telling us, that isn't the case. So we are trying to argue to make sure that infrastructure spend doesn't deprioritise the needs of SMEs. If we're seeing capital spend put in towards infrastructure planning, we need to make sure that that targets exactly what the problems are, and that includes the ferries, the A9 and other areas. Again, probably, as I've just said to Mr Mason, it's very difficult to not to balance between that monolith approach and that kind of flexible approach within the area's needs. But we want to see capital spend prioritise SMEs. It can boost innovation, it can boost business-based trade, expansion, inward investment. If we don't make sure capital spend includes the perspective of SMEs, then we could risk losing things, because you forget that the ferries matter to the small businesses in those areas. We forget that that's why tourism comes. You're not going to encourage tourism to that area if there's a ferry not running or running very infrequently. So we want to see better spend in capital, but the capital spend, as Sandy's been saying, there is money there in the capital budget, but we need to see that prioritised towards SMEs and not for the capital spend to just, you know, throw money out and hope that something sticks. We need to see where it needs to be prioritised.
That's right. Louise, if I can come to you, and full transparency, I was in one of your establishments only a week or so ago, and having been bought a gin and tonic, I feel slightly seen by your Pat Butcher comment. I have to say, I mean, fantastic. It was, you know, very well looked after, but it was quieter than I'd expect in Edinburgh on a Saturday evening. And, you know, I know from speaking with other people within the sector, there is real pressure that, you know, our town centres, our city centres aren't as busy perhaps as they would be. There's been a kind of behavioural change from a lot of people. There's also been, Michelle and I were both on the Economy Committee, where we did a report recently on that, and it was very interesting to see some of the solutions and what we need to be doing. You know, you've dealt with a pandemic, you've had the kind of uncertainty and the investment needed from DRS, you've got some other pieces of legislation like, you know, ultra-low emission zones in Glasgow, and that will be rolled out. How difficult is it to forward plan for the sector? And, you know, given the changes in approach, and obviously the UK government's providing a discount for hospitality, how are you positioned compared to perhaps similar organisations in other parts of the UK?
Our forecasting just is, it's not finger in the air, right? We are a little bit more scientific than that, but we're not forecasting any growth. In fact, in some areas, we're forecasting a decline in overall turnover. And that's really hard to square away when you are run with an entrepreneurial focus. We've got one eye on expansion, but it's nigh on impossible to see where that will come from just now. I don't want to say it's all doom and gloom, but it's really far from great. Consumer behaviours have undoubtedly changed. The working from home sort of culture is I mean, Friday night, I don't know if any of you, I mean, Friday night in cities doesn't really happen anymore. We, you know, see slightly more on a Thursday night. Lunches, people just either work from home or they bring, you know, it's just cash in pockets. So we're just having to operate to try and drive footfall, which will cover overheads, ultimately. So if you can go and get a sandwich and a drink for £10 from Pret, what can I do in one of our venues for £10 to try and compete with that? It's not going to make us any money, but it'll pay for the electricity and it'll pay for the staffing costs and the goods. So there's not a great deal of hope in the sector, I would say, just now. And yeah, a lot of the pressures are hard. I think the taxi situation is impossible. What we're seeing is people go out earlier and go home earlier because they need guaranteed. So in the past, you might have gone out at 8 o'clock for dinner. We're seeing a lot of people coming out at 6:30. And it is heartbreaking to read the end of night reports that say died off at 10, died off at 10. And you know it's dying off at 10 because people want to plan to either get a bus home or to get a taxi home, because if not, they're not going to be able to do that later in the evening. You know we lost loads and loads of taxi drivers during the pandemic to other industries, and they've definitely not come back.
And you're a chain, obviously, so you said actually Glasgow's okay for you at the moment, but others, you know, will be different.
Your city, yeah. Because it's not so much of a residential city. You know, you've got Greater Glasgow, so people have always traditionally gone out earlier and gone home earlier in Glasgow. In Edinburgh, was had a much more thriving late night economy, and obviously we haven't touched on that today. But you know, the late night economy in Edinburgh isn't anything like what it was.
Hospitality group hat on, with one kind of hat on. I mean, you know, you're a chain. You can probably cover over a larger period whether kind of bad nights in one venue. Do you worry for independent, small independent pubs, bars and restaurants?
Yeah, I mean, you were speaking about Ardamurchan in the Highlands. My husband believes that a day spent out of Scotland's a day wasted, right? So we spent the whole of summer holidaying in Scotland. So we were in Aviemore and Ardamurchan. Ardamurchan is absolutely heartbreaking to see what's going on there. One of the big hotels, they now don't let their rooms at all, and they serve food from 10 till 6. That's it. You'll be asked to leave at 6 o'clock. They're running it as a family business. I went into another hotel and watched them just turn away customers. And these French people are going, but where do I eat? And the shops are shut. The key store's shut. And the staff were going, there is nowhere to eat. It is. Aviemore was exactly the same in the summer. So, yes, I think we're lucky with the tourism and the footfall we have in the cities. But for the rural hospitality businesses, they're in crisis.
OK, thank you.
I have to see Anna Murphy on holiday back in 98 or 99, and it was exactly like that then. So there's clearly an issue in that part of Scotland. And it was all, the only thing I could get in to feed the kids with was beans, chips and chicken nuggets, which I didn't really think was particularly what I wanted to feed them, and that was a quarter of a century ago, so there's clearly an issue there. Michael?
I bet the kids loved it, though. I suppose I wanted to ask you about whether you feel there's a coherent plan for growth in Scotland. I think that the language of growth seems to be a bit more fashionable, I would say, driven by that budget gap that we've talked about earlier. And Sandy, your points in terms of how do you grow the base. A lot of what you've said today feels really quite defensive of what we have, maybe a little bit more on this side of the table than towards Sandy's side. But is there a plan from the government for growth? Rachel?
I think, as I've said, we're quite excited to see the New Deal for Business come into fruition. We've really struggled to see that engagement with small businesses for a number of years, and we know from the pandemic it was particularly hard to get the targeted support out to the right people. A lot of that was to do with the data being so poor as well. So seeing the New Deal for Business be created and the discussions around data and a small business unit within the government is everything that we want to get on board with. We think that will help growth, because you're having the discussions with what essentially, as I've said, to chuck more stats, but small businesses do make up 99% of the private sector enterprises in the economy and contribute a lot of money. They can't go unnoticed and unrecognised. And I think the important part of that is the discussions and having things like small business impact assessments be created as a standalone way to make sure that we're fully on board with where there are opportunities to both mitigate risks and negative adverse effects, but also to find where there's room for growth. We spoke about entrepreneurs, young entrepreneurs in particular, how we can see to stimulate growth in those areas. We're defensive of not taking away anything that could deprioritise SMEs. We're grateful for what currently is in there. We're aware of the difficult circumstances that every government and across the UK is currently working within, and the purse strings are tight. We want to make sure that our members don't get deprioritised, but what we're seeing when they are prioritised is we see better engagement from businesses, and we see better schemes and policies and financial decisions being directly linked to where we can see growth. And I think through the New Deal for Business and discussions of things like sustainability of Scotland's finances really gives us an opportunity to do that.
So those are discussions, but I'm not hearing much in terms of action, in terms of what those measures that are going to deliver growth actually look like.
Yeah. I think there's probably at the moment lack of kind of shovel-ready projects that could be delivered into the economy right now that could spur growth immediately in the shorter term. But then there's things like the £15 million coming in, as we've discussed, isn't a lot of money, but it's still something that we can work with and make sure there is that injection of growth. But there are more discussions to be had about what this means in practice and what this means on the ground. And at the moment, everything's a wee bit vague and everything's a wee bit kind of, there's not that shovel-ready side of things. But I think through going forward, we can start to really understand that. And I think a big part of that's transparency with the budget numbers. I think we mentioned that in our submission. There needs to be greater transparency of where the spending's going, where the linkage to spending is, and comparable budgets over the years. Previously said, as have Audit Scotland, there isn't comparable budget numbers. It's difficult to make budget submissions when we don't have a full picture to what to work with. So I think increasing transparency on spend is a huge way where we can improve growth for SMEs.
Okay. Sandy?
I would say yes, but I think the but is being talked about a lot more. I think there is an acceptance that sustainable economic growth is really important. It's the only way that it can pay for public services going forward and the public services that we want. I think the but is around the policy decisions that are going to be needed to be made to make the growth happen. So I think that we we're at fault for trying to keep everyone happy in this country. So if you look at economies around the world that do perform strongly, it's just like an organisation strategy, but bigger, which is actually, what are we really globally competitive at? Where can we really drive that growth? And what are we really going to focus on and double down on? So we're guilty of spreading everything very thin. I think that we need to really be clear about what is actually going to drive the economy over the next 5 years. Because I think that, and that's not to detract from the fact that there are future industries, absolutely, but actually what is really going to move the dial on that economic growth in the next few years? Because the challenge for public finances is today. You know, it's current. So there needs to be a way in which we can really turn that. Because economic growth is going to, if it's done in a sustainable way, ultimately will benefit the whole economy. So I think, but it's about the policies that align then behind that, which I think is going to be the hard part. Take education, skills is a good example. You know, we've got all the components, but the pipeline of people coming out of colleges, universities and apprenticeships aren't aligned with the immediate needs of the economy, far less the needs of the economy over the next 2, 3, 4 years. And there are lots of examples of industries who are crying out for skilled talent that's going to hold them back, when actually we're also producing too many other people actually who are may not ultimately end up in employment. So we've got a real opportunity to get people with the right skills into well-paid jobs, but we need changes in that part, and that's just one example.
Thanks. Louise?
We're desperate for growth. All of our members, which I think is really healthy, like there is a strong desire to grow, not contract, which shows there's still appetite, there's still hunger, there's still real talent out there that want to grow. The opportunities for growth are slightly limited just now, and your finance director is going to be in the background going, really? You sure you want to do that? So that's where the challenge is. It's the head v heart. The head's saying, stop, stop, stop. And the heart's going, no, I'm really, really, really keen. So a bit more balance would be massively appreciated and would stimulate growth.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. I want to thank our witnesses for their contributions this morning. We've run a wee bit over time, but that's obviously a testament to the evidence that's been given today. So thank you very much. We will continue our evidence taking on the sustainability of Scotland's finances at our next meeting, when we will hear from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance. So that includes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which we'll discuss in private, is consideration of our work programme. So we now move into private session. I'll just call a 2-minute break in order for our witnesses and the official report to leave. Thanks.